like you lost another one. Well, happy Saturday, everyone, and welcome to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me a bit of your most precious commodity, your time. You guys, please show my moderator, Love Jones, some love and affection, moving in the right direction, and please make sure that you like the video on your way in. Make sure you drop down in the chat box and say, hey, girl, hey, and please make sure that if you haven't already, that you go ahead and subscribe to the channel. It's a good time over here, child. We only bite with your permission, you know, if you're into that sort of thing. And make sure you click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on an opportunity to chill with us when the speakeasy is open for business, okay? So with that being said, welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to the channel, and I hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to all of my returning sippers and speakers and those of you catching this on the replay. Thank y'all for coming back one more again to love up on your girl, because y'all know I love the way that y'all love on me. So let's see who is in the building with me. Of course, Love Jones is here, moderator extraordinaire. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Marva. Hey, girl. Hey, good evening. Welcome, and thank you for being here. Hey, Nordic, welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome. Hashi Tashi Grasshopper, Welcome, learning. Hey, girl. Hey, thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Choco Chip is in the building. And of course, she brought the good vibes with her. Y'all grab y'all some, okay? It's Saturday. Ain't no reason to be upset, y'all. Everybody is going to have a good time today. All right, so listen, y'all. I just wanted to come out here and I'm nosy as shit, y'all. I just really wanted to get into this book. Child, I was looking at the Dirty D and thinking about that young fella being Messiah and trying to consider who could play ethics should this thing ever be turned into a movie, child. Listen, and I know one person in particular, that would be Miss Marva. I stand by the freezer while Saki reading books. Y'all know her as Miss Bug. She was like, Saki, listen, I don't know what them other chicks got going on, but I think you are absolutely right. Terrell Carter could absolutely play ethic. I was like, girl, yes. And then she sent me some pictures, child. And in one of them pictures, baby, that man got his tongue sticking out. Ooh, it's long. I was like, hey, tongue. I mean, Terrell. Okay, tongue. Child, listen, that thing was tonguing. Child, that tongue was tonguing. You heard me? I was like, oh, well. Baby, whoever he with, I know she happy. Child, because I'm sure he let her take a seat all the time. Well, anyway, let's stop being nasty and let's get into the book. Wait a minute. I did see that tongue, Marva. Child. Listen, oh, that's hung, and it's got a little curve up on it. I said, oh, wee, that tongue is nice, child. Anyway, all right, let me get my time stamp, child, for the synopsis. All right, so listen, today we're reading Ethic Book 4, and the synopsis reads, after facing his biggest sin, Ethic finds forgiveness within the love of his life. Alani is the woman he's been searching for his entire existence, but loving her comes with a price, his soul. She wants his soul. When Alani tells Ethic she can't be with a man who doesn't believe in God, Ethic must face his only fear, trusting something he can't see. With Alani's heart in his hands and his soul in hers, they must try to piece together a life where love and forgiveness outweigh the burden of pain they've placed on one another. Will they be able to survive their past demons and grow their once-in-a-lifetime love? Or will lack of faith end them for good? You're witnessing history as New York Times bestselling author Ashley Antoinette pens the story of her career. Step out of reality and into Ethic's world, where this brilliant character makes you believe in love after pain, growth after forgiveness. Okay, child, listen. We're going to see if it's given what was supposed to have been gave, okay? We're going to see. So, let's get it together, child. And to think, this was only supposed to be a one-off, and she ended up having to write 6 books, child, because a bunch of horny, weird women was at home like, we need more Ethic. We need more Ethic. So, I ain't mad at her. All right, let me get my timestamp so we can get into it. Okay, I hope y'all are having a good Saturday. I really do. I'm not going to be before y'all long. I'm just feeling a little nosy. Wanted to see what this book was giving and didn't want to wait till Monday to break into it. So I'm here today. All right, so we'll read till I get tired. All right, chapter 1. It's going to be fine, Ethic. I promise, Alani whispered as she sat beside him. Ethic looked at her, reveling in the marvel that was Alani Lanika Hill. She was filled with nervous energy. A leg bounced, and she leaned forward in her seat, anxiety-filled. Worry had taken residence in her. Are you okay? She asked. Ethic was full of tension. He had never been arrested, but he assumed that this was what sitting on a courtroom felt like. Only Ethic was about to be judged by something greater than the law. He was preparing to go before God. Everything in him wanted to walk out, but if he did, she would as well. Only she would be walking away from him. She would leave. This was her only stipulation to stay, to get to know God, to commune with his father. But Ethic was a child, abandoned. and he had harbored some resentments. It wouldn't be an easy reunion. Alani insisted, however, if he became acquainted, if he could scrape up even a little bit of faith, he could keep her. She would stay, and he would do anything to make her stay. He had never been so conflicted. War was being waged inside of him. Utter turmoil wrecked his soul, but for her, he remained unmoved on the outside. He nodded. I'm good, baby. His voice was deep, sturdy, sure. It was strong because he knew it was the version of himself that she needed in this moment. It wasn't what he felt, but it was what she required, and he wasn't in a position to ever be less than she needed. He wouldn't be able to fall short with her, ever. He had already done the worst. He could only contribute to her growth. Any action that negated that would be met with her evacuation. She would pull out on him, and Ethic couldn't let that happen. He had to be perfect. For her, the love she gave him was, so he had to meet her at her standard. Motherfucking perfection. Her misted eyes held so much uncertainty, so much fear. He knew she was taking a gamble on him. She was fighting so many things just to allow herself to love him, and he was grateful because he knew he was undeserving of her. He reached for her hand, and for the first time in a long time, she didn't recoil. Her participation felt like a gift. His chest swelled as she leaned into him and she placed those pouted lips on his. Her left hand touched the side of his face and he wanted to bitch up. She was back. Alani, not Lanika, had returned to him. He rested his forehead against hers and she moved her lips to his cheek and then rested her cheek against the place that she had left a lipstick stain. Cheek to cheek, as she wrapped four fingers behind his neck, her thumb caressing the lobe of his ear. She was touching him with such tenderness. I'm scared, she whispered. A tender spot formed right behind his gunshot wound because he was fearful too. Afraid of failing her, terrified to lose her, petrified to face him, horrified of the possibility that even with God in the middle, he still may not make it. He spoke none of these insecurities, however. If she was weak, he had to stand tall. He had to be brave for them both. He had to have faith. Alani spoke about it like it was so simple, like she could just arm herself with it and go out into the world to slay the obstacles of her day. Ethic knew nothing about the spiritual warfare that surrounded him every second of the day. The angels and demons fighting over the outcome of his life, a war over his soul. God versus the devil since the day he was born. Alani was forcing him to arm himself and to choose a side. To get to know the word of God and to slay those demons that had tortured him. Alani was his prayers, manifested. That much he knew to be true. He pulled back to stare into her glossy eyes. I love you. She pulled air into her lungs, long, deep, centered, conscious breathing. She was absorbing his energy. He had spoken it into the universe, manifesting a palpable feeling so strong that she could almost see it as it lingered between them. She inhaled, absorbing it. His love. I have been in love with you since the day I met you. There hasn't been a second when I couldn't feel it. There won't ever be a moment when I don't feel it, she whispered. I know she left you, your mother. I won't, not again. I'll be everything for you, Ethic, a friend, a mother, a lover, a spiritual anchor. I got lost for a minute, but I'm here now. I'll be all that, and I only need you to be one thing, she whispered. What's that? He asked. Godly, she replied. He nodded, and his face contorted in pain. It hurt so badly. The thought of transformation, the process of becoming that for her. It was like a burn, not easily cured, not quickly calmed. It scorched until it didn't, and every second until it was healed was felt. There was no speeding up the process. He nodded again, trying to encourage himself. He could do this. Maybe not by himself, but with her at his side, he could do it. He could do this and much more. With her, he could fly. So why couldn't he drop to his knees and submit to God? His eyes glossed over in turmoil. She caressed him. Just do this for me. Just try. He sniffed away emotion as he lowered his head. She cupped his face, lifting his chin. He was so broken. She had no idea how long he had waited for her, the things he had gone through, the L's he had taken. I'm good. He whispered, but his face contorted in devastation, and he bit into his bottom lip to control the vibration of it. He was struggling. She could see it, and it broke her heart because he was normally so strong, so controlled. But when facing God, control was not his to maintain. Ethic had no wins in that bout. Conviction burned in him so fiercely that his skin was hot. She was pulling out the boy in him, the boy that needed guidance. She represented everything he had been lacking for so long. Mothers were the center of the Black community. They nourished and guided and protected and educated and encouraged. He was so low on all of those things. And as he looked at Alani, he saw motherhood. He saw a God who could supply all that his mother had neglected to give him. He didn't believe in God, but he did believe in her. So maybe she was his God in all his image and all that, Ethic thought. Perhaps women, all of them, mothers, daughters who grew up to become mothers, women, the birthers, the creators, Alani, Lanika Hill, women were God. Big facts, Ethic, I'm glad you know. Now tell your brethren, okay? He loved this woman. He loved her so very much. This will help us. Do you trust me? He nodded, and he meant it. He had never trusted anyone more. The sound of the door to the church's office opening interrupted them. Alani, good to see you. Beautiful as always, baby girl. Baby girl? Ethic instantly pulled himself together. Alani was permitted to see his weakness. The outside world could never. He stood and extended his hand to the man in front of him. He was thrown by the man's informal appearance and his even more informal greeting to Alani. This wasn't the pastor that had spoken at the debutante pageant. This man was younger, comparable in age to him, dressed down in Jordans and sweatpants, with a hoodie and a fitted cap that he wore to the back. They must have been making pastors in a new way these days, because Ethic had never encountered one like this. He was built solid like an athlete, and his kind eyes rounded out cocoa-colored skin. A goatee and thick, dark eyebrows contrasted against the color of his skin. Ethic was a confident man, but he couldn't help but wonder how much healing this pastor had put on Alani. He hadn't missed that this man called her Alani, not Lanika. They were familiar with one another. They were more than familiar. Ethic shook his hand. Tight grip, stern glower, unfucking friendly, because he felt like he was in the presence of a man who had fucked his woman before. How you gonna be jealous in the church, Ethic? But okay, child, listen. Thank you for seeing us, Nye, Alani said. Alani hugged him, and Ethic felt a stir in his stomach. He was territorial. He had never been before. But this man, this pastor, was clearly connected to Alani's spirit. They had prayed together. They had communed together about God. That was something Ethic couldn't give her because he didn't believe. He felt threatened, like this man was the type of man that Alani needed. Anytime. I'm Nair, man. I've heard a lot about you. Good to meet you, bruh. Ezra, Ethic answered. Ethic's brow was pinched in uncertainty. Alani had spoken to this man about him, but he knew nothing about Nair. Alani tucked herself under his arm and feathered Ethic's chin with the palm of her hand. He exhaled his unease. Her touch, just her touch, calmed his storm. She stood on her tiptoes and kissed his lips, quick, but with need, pulling his bottom lip into her mouth. La told me you're new to all this. I think it would do us some good to take our first session outside. We can walk through the garden, talk a bit, Nair said. Ethic nodded as Nair led the way out of the door. He was appreciative because the oxygen inside the church felt thick, like it was too good for sinners like him. He pulled in the unholy air as he stepped outside. Alani walked in the middle of them as they crossed the parking lot and entered the groomed land behind the building. There were acres of vegetable fields that the church owned, a community garden where members came to feed their families. We started this garden 5 years ago. Corporations tried to come buy up the land behind the church, wanted to build a strip mall. White people coming in, buying up everything in the hood, pushing us out. I bought it and started planting. Forget the welfare, the public assistance. Mothers can come right here and pick what they need to feed the babies. We got to take care of our own, you know, the pastor said. He bent to pick a tomato from the ground and tossed it to Alani. She caught it midair. Remember to send a basket home for Nanny, for that homemade pasta sauce she be whipping up. Alani snickered. You mean the sauce I be whipping up. Every time you ask for some, she makes me cook it. Nair smiled. So Ezra, Ethic, he corrected. You can call me Ethic. Ethic, Nair said. I've seen you around here, man. Baby girl, Bella is your daughter, right? Ethic nodded, my pride and joy. It must be hard raising her alone. Alani tells me you have three children, Nair added. We get by, Ethic answered. Alani noticed his garb. He was uncomfortable. She reached for his hand, wrapping her arm through his elbow as she intertwined their fists. She gave him three squeezes. I love you. Somehow, he knew what they meant, and he squeezed four times in return. I love you, too. With her urging him to open up, he added, it is hard sometimes, man. I feel impossible. No, I'm sorry. It feels impossible some days. Those days are over, Alani whispered, pausing her step to turn to him. She wrapped her hand around his neck and kissed him again. She loves you, man. I know she struggled with that, but we've spoken a lot on forgiveness. Ethic's brows lifted. He wasn't sure how much Nair knew. For the lies, for hiding the parts of you that you knew I wouldn't accept, she clarified, easing him a bit. We always hide our worst parts. It's hard to confront them, not just in front of others, but in front of the mirror, you know? Can't show her because then you'll have to admit to yourself that part exists, Nair said. Ethic nodded. I can face the reflection. It's getting someone else to accept the reflection that troubles me. He whispered it so low that it was barely audible, that confession of loneliness, the desertion, the ineptitude of being good enough for a mate, deserving of one even. If his mother couldn't stomach him, how could he expect someone who had no responsibility to him to suffer through his presence? You would think it would be easier, connection, manifesting partnership with another. It should be. We come from connection, born from it. Man and woman connecting to reproduce that energy and reproduce themselves, creating children. The connection would have to be true in order to be replicated, though. No, Ethic responded. Can't just plant seeds in anyone and then expect that seed to grow up and know something about love. A kid has to see that coming up. It has to be a part of his world, a visual lesson reinforced every day by the people who created him, so that when he grows up, he knows how to seek that. If all he sees is disconnection, he becomes disconnected from love, from himself even. Alani stood, baffled, as she looked at Ethic. He and Nair were both speaking to her from the perspective of a Black man. It was a depth of sensitivity she had never been blessed to witness in a man. Normally, Black men were so hardened, so tough, almost afraid to be vulnerable. This complicated, eloquent exchange between two of the best men she knew was enlightening. She felt like a fly on the wall, like she was a spy for the female species, siphoning information to take back to explain the psyche of men. This was a rare occurrence, this spillage of secrets. You're absolutely right, bro. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it, Nair said. Proverbs? Alani asked, frowning. You got the stank face because you've only heard the scripture referenced in one way. The Bible is a guide that we can interpret uniquely to match our experience. It isn't cut and dry, the way a lot of old school pastors would have us think. Train up a child is about more than habit, about more than chores and teaching a kid to pray and obey. What about teaching love, showing love, modeling affection, being love in human form, so that when they grow up, they are love in human form. They are God's love in human form. Now, how amazing would it be if when you met this brother, he loved on you with God's love, with a love that was so second nature that it could never injure, never hurt. He wasn't trained up that way, so he's guessing. My G, you stumbling in the dark, trying to find her, trying to get it right, but you're stubbing your toes along the way. Ethic nodded. The heart of the father becomes the heart of the child, bruh, Nair said. If the man who raised you was heartless, if he loved you wrong, it's inevitable for you to love incorrectly. He loves perfectly, Alani defended. I never said that, Nair. After making mistakes, that's correction, not perfection, Alani, Nair said. Why must you or any woman he's chosen before you have to suffer through correction before reaching glorification? You shouldn't have to endure a storm first. That's not what love is about, putting up with hurt and being celebrated for staying through it. That silenced her, zipped her lips right on up, and she pinched evil brows at him. She didn't want him to go this hard. This couldn't feel like an ambush or Ethic would never return. She needed Nair to ease into this walk of faith like a timid child going for a swim on a scalding day. If he pushed Ethic into the deep end, it would shock his system and hit him all at once. Ethic wasn't equipped to swim. He would drown. Their chance at fixing things would die. And you know about that, Nye, Alani challenged. We're all flawed and just walking around trying to correct things we messed up before we were aware of the impact we made on others. It takes mistakes. It's what you learn from them, what I learned from them, that matters. She squeezed her fingers that were interlaced through ethics tighter. She was angry. She was defending him. You know I know better than anybody. Too many mistakes were made on my behalf. Ones that others suffered for, ones that keep me up at night, Nair said, his voice small, like it was hard to think about. Ethic observed his melancholy. He couldn't relate to his walk of faith, but he could relate to that, the somberness, the sorrow. He had made those type of mistakes, the ones that were so heavy he had to check out of reality sometimes within the confines of his basement. It was his retreat, like the church was Alani's altar. His basement was where he unloaded his burdens. Yoga. The Zen. It wasn't prayer, but it helped. It helped quiet the conscience that haunted him. The walls of this church don't take away regret. It just helps to manage it a bit. Gives me hope that I'm working toward being a better man, Nair added. Ethic gruffed in deep thought. But look, man, I'm not gonna hold y'all all day. This is just an introduction. It was good to meet you. Alani here is persistent on scheduling something consistent, but I say just let it vibe, Nair said. He pulled a card from his pants pocket and extended it to Ethic. My perspective might not be for you. It might be different than what you believe. I'm always up for the conversation between gentlemen. We all just walking around trying to figure it out. So I'm open, bro, whenever you want to chop it up. Ethic took the card and slid it into his pocket and then extended his hand. They shook. Good to know, my man. You have a good one, Ethic said. Yo, Alani. We're having dinner Sunday after service. Zora's cooking up some wings for the game. Y'all should fall through, Nair said. Yeah, we'll see, Alani nodded. Thanks, Nair. Nair headed back toward the church, and Alani rolled skeptical eyes up to Ethic. He pulled her into his arms, and she rested a cheek to his chest, wrapping her arms around his waist. Her heart was heavy, but there was no turning back. He exhaled as he kissed the top of her head, and just the energy he transferred through that simple gesture filled her with courage, courage to try, will to make it. What now? He asked. I don't know, she whispered. I don't know. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Okay. Oh, Lord. So I like the fact that the pastor's laid back because I can't stand no old uptight ass fucking, you know, Jimmy and Tammy Faye Baker ass pastors. I'm more the Creflo Dollar type of pastor. So. I heard Creflo Dollar say, you better ask some goddamn body. When he said God, I said, is he gonna say goddamn? He said goddamn. I said, okay, child, listen. If you can say goddamn, you can say goddamn. What's the difference? But okay, child. You know, hey, whatever. Hey, Kim Cash. Welcome, darling. Happy Saturday to you. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome. All right, so let's get into this next chapter, child. I'm so nosy, y'all. Why? Hold on. Let me see something right quick. I don't even, people love to send me messages. They wait right till I get live to send me messages. It's like, could you just come into the speakeasy and wait? I don't understand. Like, did you not know that I was on live or no? Because I'm trying to figure out why aren't you here? You should just be in the live stream. Like, what is the rest of all this? I don't know. Anyway, whatever, child. All right, so I got my pen. Let me get my timestamp. All right, so y'all been enjoying y'all little Saturday? I hope so. Getting your laundry done and all that type of jazz, child. That's Saturday stuff, you know. All right, here we go. Chapter 2. Morgan sat backstage, putting coconut oil all over her body. Your crew coming tonight? Mo looked in the reflection of the mirror at the white boy who stood behind her. White boy Nick was nice on the dance floor. He put it down in the stilettos better than Mo. You know that nigga Messiah ain't missing a beat when it comes to Mo's ass, Aria said from across the room as she leaned close to the mirror to place her earrings in her ears. Besides, you need him. You gotta pull a guy out the crowd for the routine, and you know he will burn this whole damn club down if you end up dancing on anybody else. Mo chuckled. What about that fine-ass boy with the tattoos? Little light-skinned. He can get it, Nick said. Mo hollered in laughter as she cut a side eye to Aria. You can get slapped too, Aria said. Oh, that's you? My bad, boo. I didn't know, Nick conceded. Aria shook her head as she applied her lipstick next. Nope, that ain't me, but it's not gonna be you either. Ain't gonna be nan bitch up in this motherfucker either. Lil Daddy and the Gucci and Ink is off fucking limits. She got louder at the end to let every dancer in the room know. How you know he gonna be in Gucci? Morgan teased. Cause the nigga's ghetto. All he know what to do. With all that paper he got is buy Gucci shit, Aria said, smiling as she shook her head. Nick walked away and Mo shook her head. But somebody that ain't feeling Issa, you sure know a whole lot, sis, Morgan said with a smirk. You worry about mean-ass Messiah, Aria said with a snicker. I've got Issa handled. Tell the truth, he popped that thing, didn't he? Morgan whispered. If Aria's skin wasn't so rich, she would have blushed. Her eyes sparkled as she shook her head. If he ever popped this, you'll know the nigga entire stilo would switch up. I'm talking nose wide open, picking me up, dropping me off, bringing me food, buying me shit, trying to be all up under me. I don't need Issa smothering my ass. I'm wild and free. I'ma die wild and free. He can't handle it. I'd fuck his entire world up if I ever let him dip in it. I know that's right, Aria, because child, listen. Anyway, Morgan chuckled and stood to her feet. She wore black dancer's bikini bottoms with ripped fishnet stockings beneath. Her high-heeled Timberland construction cleats were good and broken in. She had been walking around in them for weeks. The cropped mini champion hoodie she wore showed her belly, and she sucked in her stomach. Bitch, am I getting fat? Morgan asked as she turned to the side frowning and then admired her reflection from the back. Her hips and behind had definitely spread, and she wasn't as toned as she would like. That's Messiah doing all that damage, Aria snickered with raised brows. All y'all do is eat and fuck. Can't pay y'all to go on a real date. We date? We just not dating with you and Issa. You just want an excuse to go out with him without having to give in when he asks, Morgan laughed. Whatever, Aria smiled. We're up. You ready? Morgan followed Aria to the edge of the stage. Did you tell Messiah and the crew to sit at the tables up front? I told him. And I put the manager up on game, Morgan confirmed. Aria went out on stage. Yo, Detroit, she shouted as she clicked on the mic and switched out onto the stage. The crowd went crazy. Morgan closed her eyes, taking in the applause as she stood off to the side. Who's ready for Stiletto Gang? The applause and catcalls rang out. Stiletto Gang's popularity was growing by the day. Morgan was up to 1 million followers on Instagram, and Aria had danced for numerous artists, including a Coachella performance with one of the largest artists in the world. They were young, beautiful, and talented. They went from city to city booking gigs at local clubs, and they always sold out. Morgan was barely balancing the last few weeks of school with all the appearances they were securing. Who y'all excited to see? Y'all ready for more money? Aria hyped the deaf dancer. The crowd erupted, and Morgan felt the energy take over her body. Nerves rattled throughout her, but she knew as soon as the music began and she zoned out, they would disappear. Show us some love, everybody. Morgan walked out onto the stage with three other dancers. White boy Nick was another favorite because he didn't always join them, but when he did, the LGBT community came out in the masses to support. Morgan's eyes instantly found Messiah. He sat in the crowd wearing all black, dressed down because she knew he had cut his businesses short to show up, and that he would be heading directly back to it once he'd shown his support. Meek and Issa rounded out the crew per usual. Their entire table was silent, and Morgan smirked because she could tell they were slightly uncomfortable. Flint niggas, hood niggas in Detroit, out of their element, and undoubtedly strapped in case anything popped off. Morgan wouldn't be surprised if another car full of goons were posted in the parking lot. Precautions. Messiah leaned back in his chair, shot her a wink so she knew that his eyes were on her, and rubbed his hands together before throwing one arm over the back of the chair. His legs spread wide, arrogantly, confidently, like he knew he had both the biggest dick and gun in the room. Morgan knew both to be true. She closed her eyes, and then the beat dropped. Kanye West. Yeah, you supermodel thick. Damn, that ass bussin' out the bottom. I'ma lose my mind in it. Crazy, that medulla oblongata. Morgan lost her mind in the song as she went into a full twerk while white boy Nick danced behind her. Her personality on stage always made her stand out. She bit that tongue, threw an arrogant smirk as she rolled her body to the beat, and then slid down to one knee. Nick hyped her up, dancing to an 8 count behind her. She lifted her legs straight up in the air, and Nick pushed it down, sending her into a full split. In her mind, Messiah was under that split, and she worked him. She rolled to her feet, and her midsection might as well have been disconnected from her body the way she moved it, but nothing else. The DJ mixed in a song, slowing it down, and Morgan and Aria made their way over to Messiah's table. Messiah shifted in discomfort. Morgan smiled at his unease. He shook his head as Morgan approached, strutting to the seductive beat of Ella Mai. Only her tiptoes gracing the floor, Aria grabbed Issa's hand and pulled him up to the stage, where two chairs now sat. Morgan attempted to grab Messiah, but he shook his head, and she was sure she saw a blush as he smiled, relaxing for the first time. Center of attention wasn't his thing. No way was he getting up on that stage. Messiah turned to Meek and nodded toward the stage. Yo, bro, save me. You know this ain't my scene, he said. Morgan pouted, but accepted Meek as a consolation prize, grabbing his hand and leading him back to the stage. The crowd went crazy as Morgan and Aria circled their prey as the DJ played the lyrics. I know you're on your way to get caught up in the way. We turning night into morning. I keep you up, keep it going, make you feel a way. Yeah, I'm gonna have my way, so tell me I get it. I own it, own it, own it. Own it. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Morgan straddled Meek, sinking slowly into his lap as she gripped the sides of his face, staring directly in his eyes, lips inches from his as she hit a seductive grind. Meek lifted hands of surrender, and the crowd went wild as Morgan rolled in his lap. This was more than dancing. This was sex. This was dry humping. If the barrier of their clothes didn't exist, they would be fucking. It had been planned that way because she had thought Messiah would be beneath her. Mo tried to keep it as tasteful as possible, but the dance was just too erotic. No matter what she did, she would excite him. She felt it, and her heart fluttered in her chest. She was a woman, and he was a man, so her body betrayed her as the seat of her panties, dude. Mo was wet. Oh, my God. Issa was loud enough to make the crowd ignite. Morgan glanced to her left, but she didn't need to. She already knew that Aria was working Issa over because... well, that had been the plan. Every man in the crowd wished they could somehow switch places with the men on stage. Morgan stood on heeled feet, then placed one foot on the edge of the chair. She was grateful the grinding was over, but now her sex was in his face, on his lips. He could smell it. She knew he could because he bit his bottom lip. If it were Messiah sitting there, he would have kissed it. I'ma let you play with this. Play that shit. Stay in it. Just tell me you want it. She rolled her pussy in Meek's face and smiled arrogantly, biting her tongue as he blew out a breath. She had him stressed. She could see it. He was holding his breath and trying hard not to react, but the tension in those lines in his forehead told her he was bothered. She grabbed his head and rolled his neck forward as she twerked. I know you love the taste of it. Take a whole damn plate of it, baby. Save that shit. She released him and circled the chair as Aria did the matching 8 count on Issa. They strutted behind the fellas and leaned over them, rubbing their hands down their chests before walking around to the front and standing in front of them. Own it. Own it. Own it. Morgan and Aria ended in freestyles, and Morgan took off. In her zone, all she heard were the other dancers as they came back onto the stage. Hey, bitch, go the fuck off! Aria clapped her hands with every word. The DJ mixed in another track, and Kendrick Lamar turned her up a notch. I said, I'm geeked, and I'm fired up. Aria and the other dancers joined in, and they did a quick 16 counts. Morgan threw up two M's, bit her bottom lip as her face curled up, hitting a sexy variation of a crip walk before lifting her leg lazily, doing a strip of swag walk as she alternated from heel to heel. The music ended, and Morgan could barely breathe as the DJ shouted, "Stiletto motherfucking gang, everybody, give it up!" The crowd gave up everything, rocking the club so hard that Aria kept dancing. Morgan was covered in sweat and heaving. Her gaze found Messiah, and her smile melted from her face. He was bothered. She could see it. The tension in his shoulders was like bricks. His stare was like a beam on a gun. He was ready for a kill shot. Her heart skipped a beat as she watched him lean into his knees and rub those two fingers together. Morgan pointed to her face and used her pointer fingers to draw a smile on her face. "Smile," she mouthed to him. "I love you." He read her lips and flicked his nose, shaking his head as he rubbed his temples with one hand in distress. Meek and Issa made their way back over to the table and slapped hands with Messiah. Morgan noticed Messiah pull Meek in with extra aggression, then whisper something in his ear. Morgan's gut hollowed until she saw the smile melt on both their faces as they clowned over an apparent inside joke. Probably a death threat, Morgan thought. Morgan made her way off the stage with Aria not far behind. She walked up on Messiah and straight into his arms, weaseling her way underneath his right arm. "Yo, I'm not coming to no more of this shit, shorty. Fuck that," he whispered. "Bet you next time you'll come on stage instead of sending your homeboy," she teased. He snickered, releasing a stubborn half smirk. "I swear to God, I want to break that nigga jaw right now." He lucky he controlled his hands. "That sight don't belong in my head. Can't do that shit to me, Mo. Moving that shit like that, pussy all in a nigga face, ass all in his lap. I swear to God, you want to send me to jail." He shook his head and Morgan laughed as she kissed him. He was stubborn and bothered, so he pulled back, but Morgan grabbed his chin. "Don't play," she snapped, her long stiletto nails curving around his face. He was angry. She could feel the heat coming from him. The sex later would be amazing, heightened, because she knew he would try to punish her. He gave her a rough kiss and pulled back, but Morgan finessed his chin back to her, gripping tightly, sternly. "Stop playing with me. You know I'll show out in here on your ass. These my lips, or has something changed?" He looked away, and she pulled him right back. "You already know." He gave up. "Then act like it," she said, as she fed him her tongue. Morgan kissed him so deeply that she felt his dick brick against her. Morgan inhaled him like he was oxygen, like she had been deprived and was finally able to breathe. Messiah placed hands around her waist and then slid them down, cupping the bottom of her ass, squeezing, and pulling her into him. He was ready to fuck. She was game for whatever. Weed and cognac lived on his tongue. It made sense because she was high and drunk off him. Morgan stayed in outer space when he was around. He lifted her, made her body feel like it was vibrating. Messiah was a drug all by himself, and Morgan Atkins was addicted. He had her head gone, and there was no recovery. Gang, 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 gang! Morgan turned back toward the stage, and the crowd was hyped, chanting, demanding that they return to the stage. She turned to Aria, who shrugged and headed back to the stage. The girl was built for the spotlight, and it posed a dilemma to Messiah because he found comfort in the shadows. The DJ dropped Cardi through the speakers. "Oh, he want me to cut the fuck up out here," Aria snickered. "You leading, or you want me to make up the count?" "You can," Morgan said. She wasn't really looking forward to another set because she knew she was pushing it. Messiah was already tight about the lap dance. He was in his feelings and she didn't want to push her luck, but she was already on the stage. That ass, that ass, that ass, that ass. She bad. Anyway, I love that song. Moving on. Leave it up to Aria to throw that thing in a circle like a stripper and then open her arms wide like she was up for a challenge. Morgan looked at Messiah, who was already disinterested. She saw him blow air from his mouth as he leaned over to Issa. She froze. She shook her head and cut her hand across her neck. "I'm good," she said. "More money. The crowd love you, baby. Shine, baby girl," the DJ called out over the mic, putting her on the spot. "Mo, Mo, Mo, Mo." The crowd joined in and Morgan cut eyes back to Messiah. His brows lifted in wonder as he shook his head, those trigger fingers rubbing, her heart racing. "Let's give the superstar her own track," the DJ shouted. Morgan extended her hand, shaking it and her head to decline. Then the fucking beat dropped. Cash Money Records taking over for the 99 and the 2000s. "Oh, bitch, you better," Aria shouted. "Fuck it. body twerk like Mo. She was the queen at it. You would think she earned a living off that ass. She could earn a living off that ass. The best stripper couldn't keep up. Her arms rose in the air. She turned her ass to the crowd and clicked on, hearing nothing, feeling nothing but the beat to the music. Morgan brought one leg up to her ear in a standing split on that lyric. Her bikini was so tiny that it rolled up her voluptuous behind, wedging in the crack of her ass like a thong. Morgan Atkins had ass everywhere. She walked her fingers up that leg and then brought it down, putting hands to knees as Aria geeked up. Aria came up behind her and got eye level with Morgan's recently gained weight, pretending like she was smacking it. Then Aria joined in. The whole club went psycho as the other dancers came on the stage as hype men. By the time the song went off, there was money on the stage, a few thousand dollars if Mo had to guess. Child, listen, the duo was selling straight ratchetness and sex, but they were having the time of their lives. They laughed, making stank faces because they knew when they were on point, Aria and Mo had a shorthand with one another like a team of surgeons. They just danced well together, and tonight they were raping the stage. It felt like the best night of their lives, and they were all smiles. They had turned the club into a strip joint. There was so much money flying at them. When the song finally went off, the DJ shouted, "More money, everybody. Give it up for Stiletto Gang, 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 gang." The chant continued as the crowd joined in, and Morgan and Aria hugged while smiling as they made their way backstage. As soon as Morgan opened the door to their changing room, she saw Messiah leaning against the vanity where she dressed. She stopped dead in her tracks. "Let me go find me some business," Aria said as she backpedaled out of the room. Morgan closed and locked the door. She couldn't gauge his temperature, but his stare was deadly, and those fucking fingers, they were going. "Sire, get over here, Mo. Why the fuck you all the way across the room?" he asked. She sighed and walked into his space. Messiah stepped to the side and turned around so that he was standing behind her. He kissed the back of her neck and bent her over the vanity. Before she could even speak, she felt rough hands pulling her bottoms down, and he was inside her. Morgan moaned in approval. He was angry, so he wasn't gentle. He pulled her hair, using it as his reins as he beat up the box, driving her crazy. "Damn, this shit's so fucking wet. Who you wet for, shorty?" A flash of guilt flooded her because she had felt her panties soak during the lap dance, but it was innocent. It was just a dance, and Messiah was her man. He had sent his friend up there. She only wanted him. Messiah was all she ever wanted, and she needed him, needed this. God, just like fucking this all the time. "You," she whispered as she threw it back on him like she was still on the stage, like it was still 1999. "Yes, sire." He ran one hand down her sweaty back and then gripped her hips, pulling her into him. He split her in half as he admired the work he made of her body, his black dividing her pink, a wetness covering him, her tightness pulling him. The visual was always the best part. Her sex gripped him as she slid on and off again and again, and he bit into his lower lip. "Messiah, baby, I'm there," she whimpered as she placed hands on the mirror in front of her. They were knocking all types of makeup and lotion to the floor. Neither cared. "Me too, baby. Damn, me too." Her face twisted, and he grunted as he dug into her depths, leaving his seeds inside before he pulled out. She turned to him and sat on the vanity as she kissed his lips. "You keep showing out, and you gonna get a nigga hurt," Messiah said while shaking his head in disdain. "That shit be eating me up, shorty. You don't even know," he snickered, fucking throwing money on the stage. "I would have snatched your ass off that bitch if you bent down and touched $1. Morgan laughed and kissed him again. "I'm a hate juvenile forever after watching that shit," he mumbled. Nigga is insane, y'all. Anyway, she planted her head in his chest and hollered in amusement. "Yo, shorty, you fucking got it. No lie. I just wanted to taste that shit so I know every other nigga in this club want to eat off my plate. You know what happens when you try to take a bone off a dog plate?" She nodded. "It bites." "Exactly, shorty," Messiah said. He tapped her nose and then grabbed her hand to lead her out of the club. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. First of all, nigga, she tried to pull you up on the stage. You could have kissed it right there on the stage and been real lewd and lascivious, but you decided not to. You know, you want to sit in the dark and observe and then get mad because another nigga get turned on by your bitch. That's your fault. But thanks for the beat up, though, because, you know, nothing wrong with getting it beat up every once in a while. Anyway, all right. Let me see what the hell y'all saying. Oh, Lord, hold on. Oh, Lord, wait. Some people came in. Did I speak to Kim Cash? I think I did. Didn't I speak to you, Kim Cash? I think I did. Yes, I did. And then wait. Hey, Dimples. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you and happy Saturday. Nordic said, I'm so mad at how you reading these lyrics. Child, listen, I don't listen to that bullshit now. If he'd have had some Tupac up there, I'd have gave y'all a little something, because I know all the words to them songs. But just listen, I don't know nothing about these people that they talking about, child. A little bit of juvenile, but that's, you know. I'm sorry. Not Icebox time. Stay out my business, Marva and Saki. No, God. You a mess. Messiah and his manipulation tactics. Simple nigga shit. Yes. And to me, I hate that. Because, like, you already know you got the girl wide open like a fucking lily field. Why are you playing? If you're an angry, jealous, territorial ass nigga, then when she try to pull you up on the stage, go on up on the stage and claim that. Okay? Your name's written all on it. Seed all planted all up and through that. So why are you acting like this out in the crowd? Like, that shit is annoying. I hate bitch niggas shit like that. Like, stop being a bitch. Not smell like pussy and corn nuts in that. Oh my God. But I'm sure she watched before she went up there, girl. Like, good Google it. Yes, Messiah is crazy and jealous. Two separate things that apparently don't taste great together, child. That's all I can say. But listen, that ain't none of my business. That's her man, okay? So I'm gonna let her handle up on that. That ain't none of my business. All right, let me get my time stamp for the next chapter, child, so we can press on, Flintstone. All right, here we go. Child, listen. No God. Chapter 3. Morgan was a beauty. She knew it. She had always known it. It was the first thing people said when they saw her, ever since she was little. Aw, she's so pretty. It was a compliment she had received many times. She would read the lips of her mother's friends when she was younger, and they would say exactly that. She was Justine Atkins's walking baby doll, and because she had grown up deaf, they treated her as such. She had been handled with kid gloves her entire life until meeting Messiah. He handled her roughly. He flipped and fucked her little ass in every direction without care that she was fragile. With him, she wasn't delicate at all. She was strong. She was sharp. She was everything other than what people expected her to be. She loved the identity he gave her, the fearlessness, the feeling of importance, like she was priority number one and everything else in his life came behind her. Only after she was pleased 100% would Messiah leave her side. And if she beckoned, he came right back. Morgan stepped out of the shower and wrapped her towel around her body and then looked at herself in the mirror. Something was different. She felt it. She had been feeling it for weeks, but the two little clothes, the random nausea that hit her sometimes out of the blue. I didn't miss my cycle, though, she thought. She reached for her purse and pulled the pregnancy test from inside. She had made an excuse to stop by the local pharmacy on the way to Messiah's place. Morgan had an overwhelming inkling that she might be pregnant. She hadn't even told Messiah her suspicions because she didn't want to get his hopes up if it was a false alarm. Morgan was in love, and as she held the pregnancy test in her hands, she hoped it came back positive. Morgan is in love and dumb. Child, listen. She was an 18-year-old girl. Her first year of college was nearing its end. The world was at her feet. A baby should have been the last thing on her mind, but she desperately wanted it. She needed something secure, something that would guarantee that Messiah would never leave her life. He wanted it too. So it wasn't a trap. It was a plan. Their plan. And as the seconds ticked by, Morgan felt desperation sneaking up her spine. When had 2 minutes become so damn long? It was like 120 seconds of pure torture. She looked at the stick and her stomach clenched, filling with anxiety. Two pink lines appeared on the screen, and Morgan's legs weakened. A hollowness filled her as she brought one hand to her mouth in excitement, jumping up and down in silent celebration, her eyes filled with tears. She was pregnant, filled with Messiah, growing not just any baby, but his baby inside her. She would finally have a family of her own that no one could take away. She felt like crying, but she couldn't. She wouldn't tell him now, not tonight. It was a bad time to spring something so distracting on him, so she would hold it for now. Morgan wanted some time to wrap her mind around it anyway. She needed this. She was growing wearier by the day, afraid that Ethic would find out about her affair with Messiah. This baby would force Ethic's hand. Messiah would have to be around, and Ethic would just have to accept it. She was sure there would be static initially, but Ethic was all about family. No way would he keep up the animosity with his grandchild on the way. She put the stick back in the box and hid it under the sink, all the way toward the back, before washing her hands and emerging. Nervous energy pulsed through her. Just the revelation that she was housing life inside her made her feel dizzy. Adulation swarmed her. This was confirmation. She and Messiah would be connected through blood, through love, forever. They had created forever. To two people who had felt nothing but inconsistency their entire lives, the gift of being connected for a lifetime was worth more than gold. They had bottled up a moment in time and planted it inside. Morgan, even so, oh, sorry, so even. What the hell is happening? So even when the moment passed, they would have physical evidence that it had existed, evidence in human form that she had loved a God once, and his name was Messiah. Child, I got a feeling Ethic gonna pop that boy. He gonna catch a stray bullet to the noodle that ain't quite so stray. Sorry, I had to wet my whistle, child. She opened her towel and looked at her belly. She seemed to be gaining weight everywhere except her stomach. She was wide. Hips and ass were spilling everywhere. Morgan had always been on the slimmer side, but indulging in Messiah had added a few pounds to her physique. She was sure the baby had added on 10 more because she was vixen thick. The dancing ensured it settled on her frame just right, but she couldn't believe she hadn't noticed it before. Wonder Messiah couldn't leave her alone. He had been all over her lately. She found him standing in his bedroom, fully dressed. Black jeans, black hoodie underneath a black leather jacket. Her heart sank. She knew what night it was, and she hated it. Every Thursday, it was the same. He robbed a semi-truck, and Morgan would be up all night with knots of tension in her stomach, worrying. Friday and Saturday, he would distribute product. The rest of the week was hers. She wanted more. She needed him 24/7, safe in her arms, warm in their bed. Yes, theirs, because she had practically moved in. Messiah paused to look up at her. He always took the time to gather a mental snapshot of her in his head, just in case he didn't make it back. He wanted to be able to remember what she looked like, every detail, so that he could play it in his mind before he died, if, God forbid, someone caught him slipping. He loved her. Never did he think he was even capable of the emotion, but for her, it was present, and he was tired of hiding. "It's time to tell Ethic," Messiah whispered. "It is not time to tell Ethic," Morgan defied, shaking her head, knowing that the revelation of their illicit affair had to be planned. It wasn't something they could just pull up and admit to. Morgan wanted to be further along in her pregnancy and showing some. They needed all the leverage they could get. Keeping something like this from Ethic was betrayal. The reveal would burn him. He would be upset about her having a baby so young, but he loved her. He loved Messiah, too. He would come around, but Morgan wanted to make sure the notion of an abortion was off the table. "I'm a grown-ass man, Mo. I can't keep sneaking. You're practically living here now. I need to have a conversation with him about a few things, in fact. I fucked up. There's some things he needs to know. Some things I gotta get off my chest. I don't know how the cards will fall after that conversation, but I can't keep avoiding it." Uh-oh, perhaps this is the conversation that he was talking about and having on the phone with that mystery person, right? In the last book, y'all remember? Okay, right. Child, in their minds, they think they can. We just gonna let them, we're gonna let them have it, right? Okay, not ruh-roh. Okay. All right. He walked over to her and sat on the bed, pulling her into his lap. I know, Ethic, he won't be happy about this. He lost my sister so violently. Messiah captured her chin between his fingers, lifting it slightly, steadying her invisible crown, because he'd be damned if it ever fell. He stared her in the eyes, and Morgan could feel his love. It spread through her every time their gaze connected. You're not your sister. I know you pride yourself in being like her. Raven Atkins was the princess of the city, pretty, spoiled, but you're not her, Mo. You're the queen, shorty. You don't chase after the nigga that called the shots. You give the nigga shots. You tell me when to move, how to move. You the general, Mo. You got a fucking killer on your team. What we have is nothing like anything your sister went through. It's different. You're different, Messiah stated. She's all he'll see when he looks at us, though, baby. He looks at me and he sees Ray. I need him to be okay with this, Messiah. And if that's ever going to happen, I want to prove to him that we're different, that you're different. That requires some changes. He craned his neck back so that they weren't so close, so that he could look her in the eyes. Curiosity pushed his brows up. Have you ever thought about leaving the streets? She asked. Messiah shook his head. The streets raised me, Mo. That's like asking a nigga to leave his mama alone. They brought me up. They fed me. I can't. It's all I know, he said. It's all I've got. Not anymore, she whispered as she rubbed the back of his neck. You have me, and I have you. I want us to last. I want us to do this right. I need you to think about what's next. Next? He asked. This felt like pressure. This felt like the talk women gave men they had been involved with for years. The ultimatum that came when a ring was long overdue, or a job had been scarce for too long, or one too many fuck-ups had occurred. This was a stipulation. No matter how nice Morgan tried to make it sound, she was telling him he had to change something in order to keep her. She was elevating, and if he remained in the same place, he would lose her. He knew the day would come. Morgan Atkins was royalty. Of course her expectations would be high. She was growing, and she was forcing him to level up as well. What comes after the drugs and the heists, Messiah? What is it that you want to do that'll guarantee that you come home to me every night? If we go to Ethic and tell him about us, he will disapprove as long as you're in the streets. That nigga made millions in the same game. He's the last person that can judge, Messiah said. Yeah, and his bank account is full, but his life is empty. It cost him everything. Just think about it, okay? Morgan asked as she brought her lips to his. You're brilliant. You're running a business. It's illegal, but it's still a business, and you're good at it. There's no reason why you can't do it in the real world. In a suit and tie, with a wife and a kid waiting at home for you. The safe way, the way Ethic will approve of. I put all the bad in you, you put all the good in me, Messiah whispered. Doesn't feel like a fair exchange, Mo. You're too good for me, shorty. The best thing that ever happened in my whole fucked up life. Will you think about it? She asked. He nodded. We'll talk about it when I get back. He kissed her and then lifted her from his lap. Don't wait up for me, Messiah said as he went into his closet, hitting the numbers on the electronic safe that lay inside. It beeped open and he retrieved three pistols. Two, he put in shoulder holsters. One, he handed to her. He insisted that she sleep with it on the nightstand on nights like these, just in case. I don't want you to do this, she whispered. Shorty, we can't go through this every time, he said. He stood in front of her and swept her messy hair from her face. When is enough enough? You have money, Messiah, more than enough to live off of for years. I hate this. I never close my eyes when you leave here on Thursdays. It's my least favorite day, and it used to be my favorite because Shondaland comes on Thursdays, and you're fucking it all up, she whined. Can't even concentrate because I'm sick thinking about what I would do if something happened to you. What did I tell you, huh? I got a reason to make it home now. Before you, I would take extra risks, go too hard for the bag, and not even really give a fuck if I live to spend the shit. That's different now. Everything's changed because I know you're here, waiting for me, and if I don't walk back through the door, it's gonna ruin you. I'd never do that to you. I'm always coming home to you, Mo. She nodded. She had so much to say, but she couldn't put it on his heart before sending him out into the world. She needed him focused. She needed his heart black and cold so he could live for her to thaw it another day. He gazed at her for a long time and then lifted her right hand, the one she wore his ring on. He brought it to his lips. Enjoy Shondaland, shorty. Don't get too wrapped up in Dr. McDreamy. You know a nigga get jealous and shit. A smirk covered his face as he kissed her ring finger, and then he left her standing alone as he headed out into the night. And there's a great little chapter, child. Listen. Ah, I just got a feeling something gonna happen. Is he gonna notice she quit? Like, ugh. Messiah could become an investor in ethics businesses and get a nice little return and fucking be at home with Morgan in the evening time. Listen, I'm so damn country. In the evening time. All right. This will make sense. I know you lying. Stop it. I'm sorry, y'all. This thing tripping. All right, here we go. Morgan sat in Messiah's bed, remote control in her hand and a bowl of ice cream in her lap. The TV watched her because Morgan couldn't focus. It should have been a normal night, but there was a nagging deep down in her soul. She was about to have a baby and Messiah was in the streets heavy. It bothered her because raising her child without a father was not an option. She knew what that felt like, and no way would she want that for her baby. She had lost a lot to the streets. Messiah wouldn't be another. She hoped the fact that she was about to bring life into the world would be enough for him to hang up his hustle and legitimize things. Her favorite shows played in front of her, but she missed every single detail. Her head was spinning with possibility. Her life was about to change. She was about to receive a love that would never leave, and Morgan felt relieved because since the day her father died, love had seemed fleeting. It had felt like Ethic would wake up one day and decide that he no longer owed her father a debt and would take his love away. That's her being stupid, y'all, because Ethic would never do that. He ain't even that type of dude, but Morgan's a dumbass, so you get what you get. Anyway, like he loved her out of obligation instead of naturally. That's bullshit, because he never made you feel that way, bitch. You're dumb. Anyway, even Messiah's love could expire. She'd had to beg him for it in the first place. The love of her child would never. Morgan had been chasing. Uh-oh, I went far too many pages. Shit, wait, hold on. Let me go back. See, there's no page numbers on this. And when my thumb hit, it said Morgan had been chasing. So I keep missing the page. Okay, there we go. Morgan had been chasing permanency for a long time. Everything always came off temporary. That love wasn't contrived or agreed upon between individuals. It was as natural as the birds that accompanied the rising of the sun on a summer day. Bond between mother and child was an element like water. It replenished the weariest of souls, and Morgan's was in need of agape love. To have something solid, something real, a child of her own was miraculous. She finally had foundation, something grounded to keep her rooted. She had a reason to make something of herself because now a little life was depending on her. She couldn't wait until Messiah made it home. Sharing the news with him would relieve a bit of the anxiety she felt. Carrying a secret this huge was eating her alive. She was too overjoyed. It felt like a current of electricity was pulsing throughout her entire body. It was orgasmic, like when Messiah was inside her, because technically he was still inside her. He had put something there that would live. A piece of him, the best parts of him grew there in her soil. Morgan had to do all she could to reap a good harvest, to birth a healthy baby. Morgan was loving a man that had never been loved properly a day in his life. It was difficult sometimes. He resisted her sometimes, often preparing her for an inevitable split that he seemed to be anticipating. She knew Messiah felt unworthy of her. She hoped giving him a family, a baby, helped ease his insecurity. Child, go to hell. She wasn't going anywhere, no matter what. She was committed to riding out the storm, dedicated to finding comfort in his rough edges, loyal to his brokenness because she was broken too, and somehow two broken people had become a remedy for one another. Lord have mercy. She wished she could call her mother. It wasn't often that she thought of Justine Atkins. She had been a daddy's girl, but today, on a day when fear was lacing joy and she questioned if she was good enough to raise a child of her own, She needed motherly guidance. She desperately wanted words of affirmation to encourage her. The idea of pushing something out of her vagina, of being responsible for an entire breathing being, of the hard days of pregnancy ahead, it all had her terrified. Morgan was ecstatic to do this for Messiah, to give this to Messiah, but the not knowing of it all, the anxiety over the way her body would change, her life would evolve, had her shook. She was only 18. Would she be able to finish college? What about dancing? Was she giving up her life too soon? So many plaguing thoughts ran through her mind in that bed. Morgan kicked the covers off her body and climbed from the bed, grabbing a pillow and taking it to the mirror. She lifted her shirt. Well, his shirt, but it was hers by default because she slept in it every night she was forced to be away from him. She stuffed it underneath her shirt and frowned as she turned to the side. Pregnant. Morgan whispered in disbelief. I can pull off pregnancy. I'll dance every day so I won't get fat. I'll take my vitamins. I'll put cocoa butter on every day so I won't get stretch marks. I'll tell Ethic when it's too late for him to do anything about it. I'll get Messiah out of the streets and everything will be fine. Everything will work out. This baby won't change us. He'll love me more and we'll be a family. But what if he loves me less? What if what we have turns into something else and we become those people who love their kid but hate the person they made it with? The sound of the doorbell ringing throughout the home interrupted Morgan's thoughts and she snatched the pillow from beneath her shirt, dropping it to the floor. She frowned, then carried hurried feet to the bedroom window and noticed a car parked in the driveway. She reached for the gun on the nightstand before heading downstairs. She thought about calling Messiah. No one knew where he lived, so a random visitor at 3 a.m. should never occur, but Morgan didn't want to bother him. She didn't want to distract him from the task of unloading the semis. One little misstep could end up with Messiah dead. His head needed to be in the game, not on her, not on this pop-up. Morgan would have to handle whomever it was herself. The gun in her hand eased her worries a bit. The chime of the bell went off again, this time signaling impatience because whomever it was pressed the button three times. Irritation played with Morgan as she traveled to the door. She peeked through the blinds to find a girl standing there holding a sleeping baby on her shoulder. Who the fuck? That's in the book, y'all. She pulled open the door, confusion wearing her and irritation dancing in her eyes. The only thing that even urged her to unlock the door was the child in the girl's arms. Can I help you? She asked. The girl snickered and pushed into the home, passing Morgan like she owned the place. She looked at the open door and the darkness of the outside, and then her eyes rolled back to this girl, this storm that had swept suddenly into her night. She had a feeling this girl was about to destroy some things. A category 5, yep. This girl had come to blow shit down. Messiah! Morgan recoiled, snapping her neck back, flabbergasted at the audacity of it all. Bitch, I will beat your whole ass, baby in your arms and all. Who are you? And why are you knocking on my man's door at 3 a the fuck m? Morgan's grip tightened on the gun as she eased the safety off. The girl scoffed, curling her lip up into a condescending smile. You must be the bitch he's fucking, the one that has his head fucked up. Nah, I'm the bitch he's loving, the one that put his tongue to work because I stay sitting on that nigga face. Who are you? Last time I'm going to ask, Morgan said as she raised the gun. Intuition told her she didn't want to know the answer to that question. The answer had the potential to tear her apart. She could feel it coming. She could feel her life in flux, anticipating the change that the presence of this stranger was about to deliver. Morgan tensed. Her entire body, from her trigger finger to her bowels, to her toes, to her heart, even the hairs on the back of her neck stood tall because a woman just knew when shit was about to go wrong. She was already angry at Messiah, and she hadn't even heard what was about to roll off this girl's tongue yet. I'm slapping fire from his ass, her ass too, whole toddler about to be on the floor. Fuck that baby. God, is this his baby? Morgan was doing the math in her head, estimating, adding, subtracting, dividing, common core algebra shit, calculating in every fathomable way, trying to determine when and how this little boy had come to be. He looked old enough to be before her, but it didn't matter. Jealousy, unlike anything Morgan had ever felt, burned her. Morgan wasn't a fool. Even if this child was made before her, the gall of this woman coming to his house, causing static in the middle of the night, had to mean something. He's still fucking her. Morgan assumed. Messiah was tried and convicted in the court of Morgan, and he didn't even know anything was going down. She felt sick, short of breath, dizzy. Was it her baby? God, I'm pregnant with his baby, and he's fucking with someone else. The thought made her lose strength in her legs, but she didn't fold, wouldn't fold. Not in front of this bitch. You laying in here, sitting in this bitch like you the queen. Did he tell you about his family? Bet his ass ain't tell you that. Messiah, the girl barked. The baby in her arms whined and the girl bounced him to no avail. The little boy woke up crying, and when he turned to Morgan, she was gutted. He was Messiah's twin, down to the locks and brooding eyes. Morgan's face didn't reveal her dismay, but her insides disintegrated, started at her head and crashing to her feet like two planes that collided with her tower of love. 9/11, a national tragedy. The sight of this little boy leveled her. He's not here, Morgan whispered. You need to leave. No, bitch, you need to leave. You don't belong here. He got your ass living up in here. I could fucking kill his stupid ass, the girl snapped. Morgan felt dazed, like the girl had slapped her. She wanted to fight. She wanted to kill somebody, but she knew this girl was just the messenger. Messiah's deceit had given this girl leverage, like the girl at the skating rink. Another woman knew something about her man that Messiah had neglected to divulge. Don't press green on this bitch. Don't slap her. Don't fuck this bitch and her ugly ass baby up, Morgan thought. It burned her that the little boy was adorable. She had to remind herself that the offender was Messiah. She wanted to body Messiah Williams, baby daddy to be, ex-boyfriend to be, dead ass nigga to be, because Morgan was already making plans for murder. You let Messiah know he can't hide his family. It's a wrap for that because I'm done being quiet. I'm done waiting. You let him know. Wozie stopped by. The girl waltzed out and Morgan slammed the door. She was filled with so much rage that it blinded her. She flipped the lock and dropped the gun as she pressed two hands into the door and bowed her head in grief. A change had come and Morgan knew that they wouldn't survive. Whew, and that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, Linda. Uh-oh, Messiah, you in trouble, Nick. You in danger, boy. That nigga ain't looking so fine no more now, is he? Mm-hmm. All y'all heifers in here that was like, ooh, Messiah sound like he fine. Uh-huh. All of y'all who got a pair of crunchy panties in y'all clothes hamper right now from the other day when we was talking about the way Messiah be poking and stroking, go wash them bitches in bleach because y'all see this nigga's a fuck up from the word go. How about that? Mm-hmm. Hey, Kay. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. She said, not everybody. I'm here. I'm behind, but I'm here. Well, I'm glad you're here, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Happy Saturday, child. Listen, this nigga's trash. Messiah is trash. Ooh, garbage. That's what the fuck he is. I told y'all these niggas and they raggedy ass dicks. Y'all keep on. Keep playing with me. You heard me? The dick be good. It just don't only be good for you. You heard me? That's why you threaten to take their fucking life. I bet you they keep their pistol in its holster then, right? They may do a whole bunch of other shit, but they be too scared to fuck somebody because what nigga wants to eat his own dick after you cut it off and boil it like a bowl of sausage and dress it up all cute with cheese and relish and onions and shit, right? Mustard and ketchup. They don't want to eat it because they know after they get through eating it, you're going to blow their meat, smooth up out their taco. Game over. Wah, wah. Thanks for playing. But see, you got to say that with some authority so they know you ain't playing. Plus, you got to be a beast at the gun range so they know you don't miss. And if you do, it's on purpose. I'm about to get in trouble in this live stream. This nigga's gonna be mad. So you on motherfucking live stream? Yup. Yup. I was on YouTube talking shit. Sure was. How about that? All right. Let me get this next time. Oh my God. I'm sorry, y'all. Y'all know y'all don't know what y'all, you have no idea what you're ever gonna get when you come over here, okay? Yes, shout out to the replay gang gang, child. Whenever child, y'all know that y'all had crunchy panties from the other day when we was re when she told Messiah that she gave him permission to be rough with it. When she told his ass, if it ain't rough, it ain't right. That part. Some of these people come over here, honey, and they be expecting, you know, one of them app experiences. Fuck out of here. This ain't that. Those apps could never. You don't get real world recognition and real world relatability from an app. You just get somebody reading. And if that's what you want, then go pay for that. Otherwise, have a seat, grab a drink, and shut what's called the fuck up and enjoy yourself in the speakeasy, okay? Because that's what you get here. That's what you get here. You get a good time, okay? This is not an app for book reading, all right? All right, so let me see here. I got to redo my time stamp. Oh, I started not to come to y'all today because the Clear folks is having a pool party, child. And the chillins is out there making noise and splish splashing and shit. And of course, I don't know what it is about Clear children. They seem to love rap music and their parents don't understand what the lyrics mean. So they just playing it for the kids and dancing off beat and shit until they hear some shit about, I fuck your wife and your baby mama too. And they're like, oh my God, what are we listening to? Matthew, turn that off. Oh, mom, come on. It's my favorite song. That's my shit, mom. You know, that's how little Clear kids be talking. That's my jam. That's my shit, mom. Oh, thank you, Kim Cash. I appreciate you. Yes, all of Ashley's freezer scenes are bomb, child. Yes, they are. Right, good dick always comes with some shit, child. Oh, could you ever really love a man with bad dick? But if he was like faithful and, you know, like if he was caked up and he was handsome and he had like a great personality and you knew that he loved you, could you get past bad dick? Like, could you just overlook that? Yes, offbeat as fuck, child. Listen, oh my God. I looked out the window and was like, is he having a seizure? Oh, child. I was like, that man is having a seizure. Somebody get him. Is he having a heat stroke or something? Listen, it is hot as shit in Texas today. Like, 11 o'clock this morning, it was 93 degrees, and it felt like 107. That was the heat index, child. Listen. I know you lying. You heard me? No, ma'am. This ain't that. What is wrong with this thing? Knock it off. Yeah. But yeah. Wait. Kim Cash said, I can't. You can? Are you serious? Oh, I think we need to talk about that. Like, I don't know, y'all. Like, what you gonna do? Like, how do you do that? Like, I mean, I don't know. I'm trying to, like, how does one reconcile that? What do you do with that? I don't know how that works, y'all. I don't know, child. Listen, y'all know I ain't had nothing but two peens in my whole life. I married both of them. So for all I know, I could be getting bad dick, but it's good dick to me. You hear me? So I'm just saying, like, so I don't have a frame of reference because I don't know. But for those of you that have had more than two, and I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, I guess the more you had, the bigger frame of reference you have. No jaming. That's no judgment and no shaming for the new sippers and speakers in the building. This is a jaming-free zone. We do not judge and we do not shame, right? Ain't nothing wrong with having friendly cootie cat, all right? As long as you ain't stupid with it, right? Don't be stupid, right? But you can have friendly cootie cat. So if you have, let's say, a body count of 50, which is still relatively small if you in your 40s. Let's say if you between 30 and 50 and you have a body count of 50 or even more, whatever. I'm just throwing a number out there, but I think that's a small number because think about it. Like, what's the average relationship? 3 months, I guess, nowadays, 3 months, people be like, uh-uh, he's trash. I had to get rid of his ass, girl. 3 months, yeah, he's crazy. So you get rid of the guy. So every 3 months, you got a new dude or whatever, right? I mean, I don't know. I don't know how it works. The fuck? Like, I don't listen. Don't listen to me on this part and be like, okay, right. So I'm just saying. So you have a body count of 50, right? That's 50 different peens. Somewhere in that mix was some bad dick. I'm saying if that guy had the job, the looks, the personality, the money, right? You know, but all he had was bad dick. Are you giving that up? I don't know. Like, wait a minute, Marva said, okay, first Nordic said, no, I can't do bad dick. Marva said, with bad D, that would be a no. Kim Cash said, well, not bad. I ain't never had bad, but it's simple. You don't, like, mediocre, you could do, well, see, that. I mean, it's a thin line between mediocre and bad. Like, isn't that just a matter of perspective? Like, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I'm trying to, she said, God damn, 50? I don't know. Is that a high number? I don't fucking know. Listen, I don't judge nobody. Hell, for some people, it could be 100. It could be 200. I don't care. To me, the number doesn't matter. It's not a thing. Like, I think that women are ashamed. Listen, any dude you know, like a dude that you know that would tell you the absolute truth. So like your homeboy, don't ask your man because he going to always reduce the number so as not to make your ass feel like, you know, you dealing with a slut pocket, right? Because nobody wants slut peen, right? But you got to think about it. Is anything wrong with a dude that used to be a slut in the back in the day because they've had a variety and they've learned how to perfect their game? You want them perfecting their game on actual human beings and not on apple pie like in the movie, because the apple pie can't say, no, nigga, that hurts, right? So, I mean, is 50 a lot? I don't think, so if you ask your homeboy, you know, he'll tell you that, like, I don't think 50 is a lot for a guy or a girl. I don't personally think it's a lot. I mean, but I'm 54. So, like, I don't think that's a lot. I guess y'all say, God damn, Saki, you really don't know, do you? No, I don't. I don't know. But I don't think 50's a lot. What's wrong with 50 dicks? And you're 50 years old. I mean, you've had some relationships. Most people start fucking somewhere between 16 and 18 or sometimes earlier, right? No shame. So, and you run through some dudes, right? Because everybody ain't waiting 90 days, like, miss me with that bullshit, okay? I just sat here and watched a show today where a girl had three dudes that could have possibly impregnated her. So I know motherfuckers ain't waiting 90 days. She didn't wait no 90 days. Oh, motherfucking guys. Because if that's the case, then the baby could have only had one pappy as a possibility. So I'm just saying, right? Is there something wrong? Is that why is that a high number? Why is that bad? I don't understand why that's bad. You know, I don't think that if you ask your homeboy, like, that would tell you the truth. I mean, like, dudes be fucking, and they got to be fucking somebody unless they fucking each other. Listen, I live in Texas, child. You never know, okay? I'm gonna say this. If I had come to Texas as a single woman, there ain't a dude in Texas that I would be looking at, because there are a lot of men that are on the DL down here, okay? And to me, if you're a bisexual man, that's your business. My thing is, I think you do the world a disservice, and especially Black women, when you don't tell the truth about that. That's a problem for me. When you don't tell the truth about that. Now, this conversation don't went all the way because we was talking about friendly coochie. But my whole point is, could you live with a man that had bad pink? Hey, wings and mumbo sauce, what's happening? How are you? Welcome. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Oh, shit. I bet you Denny dip his toe in here, too. Child, listen, you know they can smell each other when they're around. You heard me? Like, uh-oh. Watch out there now, Marva. Don't have nobody fighting in my speakeasy today, Marva. No, 50's not a lot, depending on age. And like I said, hell, I know some men that's done had a hell of a lot more than that. They be like, 50? Shit. I had 50 between 18 and 20. Fuck is you talking about? Right. That's what I'm saying. You know? So I don't think it's a bad number. I don't. So my question is, could you stay with a man if he had everything but good pink? I didn't say size, man, for the size queens in the building, because y'all, some of y'all was like, oh my God, don't nobody want no little dick Larry. Okay, so let's just say he had the right size. He just didn't know what to do with it. He didn't know how to work it, how to rotate and play with it. You heard me? Right. So could you stay with him if he was a good dude in every other aspect? Treated you like a queen, laced you up, right? Good to look at, right? Actually loyal to you and faithful to you. He just didn't know how to fuck you right. You mean to tell me you gonna leave him for Ray Ray up the block, who you know fuck everybody, just because he got dick and can, you know, make the queen rise to the top? Is that what y'all telling me? I'm trying to understand, like, somebody tell me what's up. I need to know. Maybe we have to implement toys and other. She said toys and other people. Oh boy. Lord, this is quickly turning into an after hour. She said toys and other people. The toys, yes. The other people, I'm not judging. I just want to know if I can watch. That's all I'm saying. Y'all know I like to get my voyeur on. I like to watch. I'll hold your camera for you, child. You know, for research purposes. You know what I'm saying? So you can watch yourself back and learn how to drop it like it's hot and sweep the flow with it. You know, it's like sometimes you need to watch yourself in order to know how you perfect your game. You know what I'm saying? That's how you shine your stuff up, right? You got to watch it back. So you just need to rewind the tape, but it's kind of hard when you put it on a tripod. So you have me, I sit in the corner, you know what I'm saying? And I get the good angles for you, so you can see everything, right? Just pay me no mind. I'm going to be moving around, you know what I'm saying? Making sure I get all the angles for you. You know, for research purposes, I'm just saying, right? All right now. But so anyway, y'all like, fucking freak. Mighty goddamn right, I am. I do like to watch and to be watched. Argue with your weird ass neighbors. Not me, because I don't give a damn what you think about that. Okay, so Nordic was honest and said, I won't leave, but we'd have to figure it out. So what does figuring it out look like? What does that even look like? I mean, I don't know how that, what do you send them to, sex class? Do you engage the services of a sex therapist? Right? Because some of them, child, got to fuck your man in order to teach your man. And I don't know that, you know, y'all would be open to that. You know, not all of them, but some of them do. I've met some that don't. They instruct, which is very hard for men to maintain, you know, to keep that tree trunk trunking, you heard me? With somebody standing there instructing, like they have performance anxiety. Other times they actually hop in there and be like, listen, let me show you what to do, okay? And, you know, and of course the couple is open to that. Me personally, I'm not. Ciao. Honey, hush, no God. But I'm just saying, you know, and I would catch that on film for them if they needed to, you know, for instructional purposes. You know what I'm saying? So they can run it back so they can learn. You know, have the lesson on repeat. You heard me? Anyway, so Kim said, I think that depends on age. If I'm 20, hell no. If I'm 60, I'm fine with that. Okay, with having a body count of 50. Well, I'm not shaming anybody because I just feel like, you know, men are allowed to have as many notches on their belt as they deem, or not even as they deem, as they can get, right? Because it's all about opportunity for them. Men are allowed to have that. But for whatever reason, women are shamed for having lots of notches in their bedpost. And my question is, well, who do y'all think the men with all the notches are fucking? And do you think that if she has fucked just that man, that she's going to know how to do whatever? No, because he ain't sticking around. Remember, he just there for the notch. So he get a notch and she get a notch. What makes you think that there's something wrong with that? Why is there that double standard? I don't like double standards. But that's just me. We don't live in a world run by me. Not yet, but soon come. She said, I like being watched, so welcome. Okay, that's all I'm saying. You heard me? So she said, I will definitely have to be a swinger. So he could be a good dude with bad pain, and you would be a swinger to get your needs met. Okay. Yes, indeed it does. Iron definitely does sharpen iron. Watch out then. Listen. I ain't mad at that at all. She said toys and other people. Okay, okay, okay. I ain't mad. I'm not mad. Not the sex therapist. Nordic said, I'm an open book. I'm open to all the, I'm like MasterCard. I'm here to master the possibilities. Okay? Whatever it takes. Toys, people, therapists, whatever. Okay? To help get that pain to the proper performance. I feel you. Okay, so I said all that to say, wait a minute. Once you break out that GoPro, that's when you know it's drastic. Right, that's the only way you know, right? But see, you know, like think about it. In the middle of everything, if you don't have a frame of reference, you're thinking, okay, wow, this is great, you know, because think about it. We were all virgins once, right? So we think the first time was great. Oh, boy. But when you hit your stride, you learn the first time was trash. Unless, of course, your first time was with somebody with more experience than you. Right? Then, and they've perfected their craft now. Because you could have somebody with more experience than you, but if their experience is all trash, then all they're giving you is experience trash. But if there's somebody that know how to stir it up like coffee, okay? I'm going there. You know, then of course they are bringing you the experience, you know, that you need. So your first time won't be garbage. Right? It still will be painful, but it won't be garbage. My point though is that everybody has to find, I don't want to say your stride, because you could find your stride in the middle of something horrible because you both learn. So my thing is everybody has to find their definition of good and bad, because some women are okay with the jackhammer of it all. I personally would punch somebody in the face. That's not to say that every once in a while you don't want your man to go from, you know, oil drill to jackhammer on that ass, because it just depends. However, you don't want the whole session to just be jackhammer because, well, we're women and you know what I'm saying, right? You don't want somebody to just get a shit a black eye like every single time, right? Every once in a while, you want to switch shit up, right? You want to change it up. You require a different stroke. Listen. Even surfers get tired of riding the same wave. So you got to switch it up a little bit, right? That's how you learn and grow and perfect your game, right? So my question is, if you've only ever had one type of game, how do you know, right? And then the section B to that question is, are you willing or is it right to dip out on trash ping if everything else is good? I really feel like, y'all, that is, because a lot of women stick with Ray Ray simply because he know how to fuck. They know he ain't shit, but it's something about the way that he, hits the bottom, the way he makes it cry, like Sammy said. That's why they stay with his ass. And other good dudes come along and be trying to get with them, and they ain't trying to hit that shit at all. Yeah, they ain't trying to hear that. They stay with the trash guy. Y'all leaving? I don't know. I don't know. People create that standard, and I don't move based on the people standard, right? More experience, hence Morgan and Messiah. Well, see, I don't know, because think of, well, yeah, he's more experienced than she, obviously. He's more experienced, but he's also just a trash ass dude. Messiah is trash, y'all. Like, there's no getting around that. He's trash. Okay, Nordic said wings. What you mean? Explain, please. Wait, what wings say? Oh, she's saying when you watch it back, I think that's what she's saying. That's the way I interpreted it. Right, because if you don't know when you're in the middle of getting it, then when you watch it back, if you look at it from the perspective of a movie, you would see the movie of you with trash peen and go, damn, that nigga did trash. Because you may not have the frame of reference until you catch it on film. You thought it was great, but when you watch it back, you're like, oh my God, that's trash. Or until you get with somebody else that know how to, flip your ass like a flapjack at IHOP during the Sunday afternoon brunch rush, that part. Messiah is trash, but he fucked the girl good. Of course, yeah. She doesn't have the frame of reference, because remember, her first time was trash. Her first time was an assault by two different people. So she don't know. Messiah's the first guy to, you know what I'm saying? I mean, now think back to that other book that we read. Y'all other folks weren't here. Yes, okay, right. Rewatch the movies and take notes, right. Absolutely. Yeah. So, in the other book, remember that girl, I forgot her name, Precious, I think it was. Precious used her next door neighbor so that she could learn, right? Wasn't that Precious that did that? Used old boy next door. And then she trapped her a baller or three. So you have to learn somewhere, right? Morgan doesn't have that. This is Messiah is it for her. She don't know no better. Yeah, right. That's what I'm talking about. So she, I mean, and yeah, I mean, apparently from what I read, he put it down. Lord have mercy. But we're getting it from Morgan's perspective. In her mind, until we know, until we see like that scene that was in Lace. I don't even know if y'all went and watched that scene, y'all, because I couldn't even tell you what episode it was in. But until you see that scene, y'all, listen, that boy's woman is happy. You're she probably was like, you did. I seen with her. Lord have mercy. Damn sure did. He did what needed to be done. I'll give him that. All right. So, anyway, y'all have said that y'all are only going to stay with good-looking guy, caked up, with great personality, with trash peen, if you can have some dick on the side, if you can have you a side piece, or if he's willing to implement toys and therapy and quite possibly other people. Other than that, y'all leaving his ass. And I'm not judging y'all, but that's fucked up. Y'all gonna break that man's heart because his dick raggedy. Send that man to dick school. But you know why he think his shit is the bomb, right? Because bitches be lying to these niggas like, oh my God, it's so good, daddy. It's so good. And it's trash. She telling him that because, you know what I'm saying, he caked up. And she telling him that, you know, oh my God, he's the best, the biggest. You know, he's the love of her life. Until she get her a ray-ray that's between baby mamas. And he beat it the fuck up. And now her nose wide open. Okay? Yeah. So, you know, good guy with trash peen thinks his shit is the bomb. Because nobody had the nerve to tell him the truth. That, sir, in every other aspect, you are wonderful. But your dick is raggedy. It's raggedocious, sir. Stop playing with these niggas' minds and lying to them, telling them it's his. It's the best. He go the deepest. He the biggest. He's king ding-a-ling. Child, listen. Tell that nigga the truth. Hey, man, the fuck is you doing? Get up off me with that bullshit and go learn how to fuck. And don't come back until you know how to fuck, okay? And lock the door on your way. That's it. Stop lying to these dudes, yo. Right, he got to take it up with his ugly neighbor, that part. You know, that's what I'm saying. No, God. Right. Don't stop feeding their ego. That's the problem. So many women stroke these men's egos. And then when you stroke their ego, they think they're, you know, they the shit, right? And then they get with somebody and she like, what the fuck did he think he was doing? He thought he was the shit. Because like y'all know, women will lie. Right, like he's King Pickle and he's a fucking gherkin. No, you're not. No. Mm-mm. But the whole idea is women will lie to these men to get their money. Think back to Waiting to Exhale. Remember old girl was telling Michael that Michael was the shit? And she was like, oh, yeah, baby. Oh, it's so good. Oh, right line. So Michael thought he had really done something. And she was laying there thinking, is he even in yet? That part. So when women lie to men like that, and tell them that type of bullshit, they come to you thinking that, you know, they the bomb.com. And they're really not. You know, it's like the difference between a fucking sparkler and an M80. Nobody even fuck about a sparkler on the 4th of July. Everybody wants the fireworks that go boom. That part. Okay? Right, she was like, what the fuck was he doing? Right, and he was up there sweating. I mean, he rolled off of her sweating bullets, and then talking about some she was like, does this nigga think he just did something? Right, he was making all that noise and shit. I'm like, oh my God. And then what did he do? You're a beautiful woman. I could buy you a house out in, what did he say, Scottsdale. Right. He wanted to buy her a house in Scottsdale, Arizona. Nigga, please. Your dick is trash. Fuck out of here. Mm-mm. No, sorry. So he believed that, you know, he was the shit. And then what did he do? When she pulled back, he gave her a hard time. Mm-hmm. Gave her a hard time. Treated her like shit. Because she hurt his ego. Bust his fucking bubble with his stupid ass. Child, listen. Yeah, Waiting to Exhale, child. The fuck out of here with his punk ass. So, anyway, Messiah is trash. He's a trash ass man with good dick. That's what y'all like. That's what y'all just said. Hold on 1 second, y'all. All right, sorry about that, y'all. All right, so anyway, child, wait, what did you say, Nordic? You said, no, nah, I wasn't part of that team of thinking Messiah was good. No, not that he was good. We said that he was a trash bag guy with good dick. Now, we know you thought he was trash. You said that yesterday, that you thought he was trash. So, because you know things that we don't know. So, yeah. But for those of us that are hearing this for the first time, you know, and the ladies who got the crusty panties right now in the hamper from yesterday's reading, the shoddy panties was moist after what I read yesterday, child. Messiah was put down. The crusty panties ain't feeling so good now, are they? Oh, some of y'all sprang a leak yesterday from that scene with Messiah. Watch out there now. Mm-hmm. But it was trash. He's a trash guy. All right, so let me get my time stamp together, child. And then we can get started here. Hold on. Chapter 4. Yo, my G, no daredevil shit tonight. You give that bitch plenty of room to come to a stop, Nick warned as he straddled his Yamaha and stared Issa down with stern eyes. I need the thrill, boy. I got my part covered. You just worry about busting that bitch open, Issa stated. The pair put the ski masks over their faces and then put helmets on top of those, leather gloves on their hands, leather jackets on their frame, all black, everything. That part had dew in their panties for Messiah. Child, listen. Hey, lover boy, where your head at? Issa asked, turning his attention to Messiah. On this money, where it's always at, bitch-ass nigga, Messiah cracked. Messiah looked at the phone screen. He had sent Morgan a text, his normal routine, an emoji of a butterfly, their form of I love you. But she hadn't responded. She always responded. His gut churned. He slid his phone in his pocket and started his bike. He gripped the throttle and the brake simultaneously, making his engine come alive as his tires spun, burning rubber. Eyes up, Meek called, a ritual, the thing he said before every job to let the team know to stay on point. The trio took off. The highway was deserted at this hour. They passed a few straggling cars on their way north, but they knew the two-lane highway the semi they had targeted would be empty. It took them an hour to ride up on the driver. It was all fun and games as the trio raced and hit wheelies, doing tricks, blowing time until they saw the taillights ahead. They were connected by the Bluetooths in their helmets. We got action, Issa said, his voice floating through Messiah's helmet. He was right on schedule. Messiah pressed play on his handles, and Kendrick Lamar filled his ears. This what gods feel like. Yeah, laughing at the bank, or laughing to the bank like, aha. He hit the throttle and the machine beneath him lunged forward. Issa sped past them both, passing the truck. He always led. Messiah took the middle, handling the driver, and Meek blew the doors off the back. 1 second. Teamwork made the dream work. Issa sped in front of the truck, and without warning, he turned his bike into the path of the semi. Nigga, give yourself room, Messiah shouted. What's wrong? Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Talking to my son. Into the Bluetooth. Issa was a daredevil and he gave minimum leeway for the 40-ton truck to come to a complete stop. It took a semi much longer to slow its speed without fishtailing. Issa was only a few hundred feet in front of the truck. They had the stopping distance down to a science, but Messiah liked to leave room for error. If the driver was sleepy or not paying attention and his reaction time was off by even a few seconds, Issa would be a memory. Messiah's chest tightened as he watched the brake lights illuminate on the truck. Then he heard the horn honk. "I got it," Issa replied cockily. The truck fishtailed slightly as the driver panicked, realizing that Issa wasn't moving out of its path. Messiah reduced his speed, lining up with the door of the truck, pulling his gun, aiming it at the windshield. He pulled the trigger twice, warning shots to let the driver know he'd blow a hole through something if he didn't pull over. The driver skirted to a stop, pulling over onto the shoulder of the highway right on point where they had a U-Haul tucked away, hidden in the brush on the side. The semi stopped a yard in front of Issa, who had two guns pointed at the front of the windshield. Meek slid to a stop, turning his bike sideways and hopping off. Messiah pulled off and opened the driver's door. "Please, man, I don't want no trouble," the driver said with his hands up. Messiah pulled him from the truck, sending him flying to the concrete, and then sent a bullet through the radio. He heard the shotgun as Meek popped the lock off the back and Messiah walked the driver to the rear. "Get your ass in there," Messiah coached. "We got 3 minutes," Messiah called out. They cleared as much as they could from the semi in that time and then drove their bikes into the back of the U-Haul. Messiah grabbed the driver. "Where's your cell phone?" he barked. The man dug in his pockets with shaky hands and Messiah snatched the phone, tossing it to the side of the road before locking the man in the back of the truck. They hopped into the U-Haul and pulled away into the night. Easy money. It took all night for the crew to inventory the take. "It's good money, G," Meek said. "We'll pull it out in the streets Saturday. It'll be busy tomorrow," Messiah said. "Mo got that ass locked down," Issa cracked. "I'm taking that trip upstate," Messiah said. Issa and Meek steeled as they both looked at him in shock. Messiah pulled the door to their storage locker closed and put the lock on before turning to his crew. "That means one of two things. We either going through with the play or we pulling it off the table," Meek said. "And since Morgan clearly complicates things, it's off," Messiah confirmed. "Yo, Unc on spaz," Issa said. "I'll handle him," Messiah said. "I ain't even stopping by the crib first. I'm headed that way now. It can't wait," Meek nodded. "We on the ready either way, bruh," he said. "Just let us know the word when you find out." Issa's phone rang and he pulled it from his pocket, smirking. "Let me guess. Allie?" Messiah said. Issa tucked his phone and then hopped on his bike. "Nah. Yeah, okay," Messiah snickered. "I know what that college thing do to a nigga, bro. Shit's like quicksand. Don't get stuck." Issa shook his head, but couldn't contain the smirk that played on his lips. He held up two fingers to the side of his tattooed forehead, saluting his goodbye before he took off. Meek departed next. "Get at me when you get back, bro." "Yup," Messiah called out before riding out in the opposite direction. He was headed to face the one man who terrified him, the only man who terrified him, his father. Y'all listen. All right, there's a little break in the chapter. Messiah sat across from Reggie Bookie Grant. The tension at the table could be cut with a knife. Messiah took in his father's features, and it was like staring into a magic ball, looking at himself years aged. "You want to tell me about Morgan Atkins?" Bookie asked. "We're not talking about her," Messiah said. Bookie chuckled as he closed the novel that was in his hand. "You dictating a lot these days. One shot of good pussy got you thinking you the boss," Bookie said. "Huh? I dictate that. I'll kill a nigga over that," Messiah stated. "Anybody can lay down over that. I'll pop a motherfucker just to get behind these walls and take care of a nigga that say her name the wrong way in this bitch. Even you, old man. Now play with me." The threat was clear. Messiah hadn't come to pussyfoot. This wasn't a friendly father-son visit. He was there to place his flag in the sand. He had straddled the line between the Williams clan and the Okafors. He finally pledged allegiance. He was rocking with ethic. Morgan was on that side. It was the only side that mattered. Wherever she was, it was where Messiah would be. He didn't care who he had to snake to get to her. He saw lightning strike in his father's eyes, and Bookie leaned into the table, sneering, his gaze deadpanned right on Messiah. "So, you aligning yourself with the man that killed your brother? The family that put me behind these walls, that's what you telling me? Benny Atkins set me up and put me behind these bars for the rest of my life. Blood ain't always family. Sometimes family is the people who choose you," Messiah said. "I will send a nigga to slit that pretty piece of pussy in half, fuck her real good before they cut her throat. Maybe that'll get you focused," Bookie sneered. Messiah was over the table before he could stop himself. He banged Bookie's head against the concrete so hard that blood leaked from Bookie's ear. Oh, Bookie, see, I done called a nigga Bookie. That's who he acting like. He was pulled off his father by armed guards and placed in cuffs immediately. I will fucking kill you. Erase you, nigga. I ain't the same weak-ass little boy you used to lock in closets. Be careful with me, bookie. Messiah was rabid as he spit on his father in a blind rage as he bucked against the guards who apprehended him. You just made your bed, son, bookie shouted as he struggled to his feet, snatching away from the guard that tried to assist him. Now you just dug your grave, pussy, Messiah thought as they dragged him out of the visitation room. And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, wow. So wait. Messiah's family was at war with Ethic's family. Wow. Okay. That's what Iman was talking about don't nobody see how this is wrong. Ethic must not know who Messiah is. Oh, shit. Okay, you said Messiah is what? So they're saying that well, I forgot the her father's name. Benny Atkins put this man in jail. But no, because what she just said in there, I just read it. Said it had you siding with the Okafors. That's Ethic's last name. He said you siding with the Okafors. So he said Benny Atkins set me up. And Ethic is the one that killed your brother. So maybe his brother was the dude that got killed inside of what you call a house, maybe. I guess we're going to find out. Let me just stop bullshitting. So it had nothing to do with, oh, only because Morgan is in his custody. Okay, gotcha. Thank you, Nordic. So you've read it, and now we know. Okay, thank you for that. Child, listen, somebody must have went live because everybody is leaving up out of here. Bye, y'all. Shit. I don't give a damn. All right, I'm here to read and enjoy myself. All right, y'all will come back and catch the replay or whatever. All right, so let me get my time stamp for this next chapter. Y'all up for another chapter? Because I ain't going to finish this book, obviously not today. But I will do another chapter or two. What is going on with my damn pen now? Not yes, let's go. Okay, all right, all right. Okay, all right. So let me get my next time stamp. Now this pen gonna act a whole ass donkey. Hold on, y'all. Shit. Okay, sorry y'all. I had to go grab another pen. Move this one right. Yes, it writes. All right. not as thick as my last pen, but it'll do in a pinch. Chapter 5. The panic that filled Alani when she opened her eyes crippled her. There was so much indecision, so much guilt that she was managing inside her that it made her want to flee. I'm so sick of this, Alani. I see she acting a donkey in this book too, child. Listen. To be a mother and make this decision, to trample all over the memory of her daughter by being with Ethic was difficult. It eroded her morality and deducted so much of her maternal instincts that she felt foolish. It was something she would fight every day she chose to stay with him. She hadn't realized how strong the urge to run would be first thing in the morning. It was when her dreams merged with her reality. Kinsey lived in one place, Ethic lived in the other. When they met, first thing, with the rising of the sun, it was like an injury, like a bullet, similar to the one she had plugged Ethic with. She rolled over and put burdened eyes on Ethic, sleeping beside her. He took her breath away. He was beautiful, the type of man that he was, handsome, just didn't suffice. The structure of his face, even through the scars from burns long healed, was magnificent. The depth of his shade of noir was custom, like God had been forced to mix two colors to create this particular pigment. The way his chest moved up and down as he breathed slowly, the definitive lines that separated the muscles he worked hard to keep lean but strong. His wide nose, full beard, pillowed lips. She inched over to him, invading his space. He had a peculiar scent to him, cologne mixed with her sex, and it was lovely. It was their chemistry, the aftermath of their lovemaking, and he wore it well. She would douse him in it every night, just so she could wake up to it in the morning. She had missed him terribly. She was back now, fighting turmoil, but it was worth the battle. 8 hours worth of trapped air blew from his nose, and it came along with a light snore, and she smiled. Even his morning breath was perfect. They had missed so many milestones in their relationship. There was no dating. There was no getting to know one another's favorite colors. No simplicity, just straight to complicated. Straight to fighting and fucking. One second, y'all. Okay, thank you, y'all. I appreciate y'all patience, child. Oh, my goodness. All right, hold on. Make sure I got everything together here. Because I literally thought I was tripping for a second. Hold on. I got it together here. I don't know why my thing was acting like that, but whatever. All right, thank you, y'all. Y'all be so patient with me. And where are the other ink pens? Yeah, oh, it's got to be in there with those. Yeah, because it's all the way out. And I had to get this other one, and I don't like it because it's too thin. You said the saga continues with Alani? Child, listen. All right. Alani didn't want to skip those little steps. If the difficult things were the foundation of a house, the simple things were the paint on the walls, and everyone wanted the perfect aesthetic. What the hell? She nuzzled beneath him, infiltrating his space. He laid on his side with one hand tucked behind his ear, and she used that bicep as her pillow, then wrapped one arm around his waist. His dick pressed into her, hard and strong. Temptation. A reminder that she would die if she ever had to imagine him with another. Green eyes popped into her mind as she pinched her forehead. Damn, just the thought injured her so greatly. She opened his legs with one thigh, scooting closer, and he groaned, but open to her. I gotta leave before the kids wake up, she whispered. That one sentence put a gloom over the room. It was the exact way their day had started the morning she had found out about his role in her daughter's death. Almost the same words. Alani felt a stir in her soul. Damn if you do, Ethic replied, voice gruff like it was hitting potholes on the way out of his dry throat. It was a duet of baritone and sleepiness. He was fighting the haze, trying to awaken for her, and it was a lovely melody. He hadn't even opened his eyes yet, but he spoke. They know you. They love you, baby. Ain't no more of that. The hiding, the fighting it. They can see you. But what if something changes? I just want to be sure. His lids lifted, and dark storms spun in his irises. Worry, fear of losing her again, live there. Nothing's changing. Whatever I gotta do to keep you here, I'm gonna do, Ethic said. Alani closed the space between his face and hers, kissing him. Neither cared about the staleness in the air between them. He inhaled her, using his strength to roll her onto her back as he filled her all in one motion. He parted her essence without asking, and she acquiesced, blooming around him. He never released her lips, and Alani smiled. And this type of love to wake to call her own without pretenses made her feel lucky. Sex at night, sex in the morning, sex whenever she wanted because he was hers. She had to stop punishing herself for that and just relish in it. This feeling, this mental orgasm that accompanied his lovemaking was unlike anything she had ever experienced. His mouth left hers and a moan escaped her. His victim, he moved to her neck, then pulled back to wrap those full lips around her areola, swirling his tongue around the dark circle, pulling on her taut nipple, making her body scream. How he could focus on pleasing her in so many places, Alani didn't know. Alani couldn't walk and chew gum at the same time without fucking it up and biting her tongue. The rhythm of his strokes deepened as he wrapped one arm beneath her body and pulled her into him while still paying the utmost attention to her breasts. This nigga was an assassin, and he was murdering her pussy. Missionary had never felt like such a thrill. He worked her over too thoroughly to call it bland. It was perfect. It allowed her to see him, and for him to see her, for their connection to be witnessed. It was intimate. It was her favorite way to partake in him, on top of her, warming her, securing her as his dick entered her, worked its way right up her stomach and tapped on her heart. Alani's legs trembled, and he lifted slightly, gripping her calves, raising them in the air, pushing them backward so he could go deeper. Her knees met her ears, and Alani normally would have tensed, but with Ethic, Alani trusted him. She lost it in bed with him. The cautions she used with every man before him disappeared. He was such a grown man. He never rushed. He never hurt her by chasing his own pleasure. He escorted her toward hers, leading, guiding them both to a place so sweet that Alani felt hypnotized. It was the little things he did, like the kiss to her left calf that made her delirious. He left no part of her unloved. What man saw the value in a calf? Ethic? Only him. He needed to teach a class on how to make a woman feel appreciated. So many men around the world could learn a thing or three. Women would go to the ends of the earth for a man like Ezra Okafor. There would be no fighting, no power struggle, no back talk. If every man was a model of this man, women would submit willingly. The level of security he provided allowed room for a woman's vulnerability. No need to be hard when a man kept you this safe and allowed you to be soft. No need to lead when he never got lost, never led you astray. No need to control when he had everything under his control. No room for worry because he expressed none. And if he did, she didn't know it. No need to question because he didn't fill her with insecurity and then call her crazy for expressing doubt. No stress. No inadequacy. God, ethic was a luxury, and he was providing her with a standard. Excellence was becoming her expectation, and nothing less would suffice. If Alani ever left him again, she would have to prepare herself for loneliness because no one could ever replace him. Stop fighting it, baby. I feel you. Give me that shit, he groaned, lowering into her ear and then biting the lobe softly. Alani cried out as she erupted. Just like that, he coaxed. Spasms hit her, and she shook beneath him. Damn, he groaned. He put both hands on her waist, pulling her onto him. As he picked up his pace, he was close. The tension on his face gave him away. He rolled back on his thighs, lifting her body onto him as he came. Hours of lovemaking weren't necessary with Ethic, although she often received them. But he was a master with a hot 20 minutes. It was like he was a chef whipping up a quick meal, making dinner of her body, using each second wisely so it wouldn't take all day. Even when it was a quick meal, it was always excellent. Oh, shit, he moaned. She clung to him, sweat acting as goo to their skin, her breasts against his chest, her lips on his tongue meeting hers. Mind-blowing. My kids can see you, he reiterated. It was how he got his way. He fucked her into submission. He didn't play fair, but Alani offered no protest. She nodded as she nuzzled her nose with his, staring him in the eyes, in a trance, so in love. She sighed, leaving her dream behind. She could do this. She could split her day right down the middle, being loyal to her child in her sleep and loving Ethic all the hours that she was awake. She knew her nights would grow shorter now that she had a game plan. Now that she had set some rules, she would want to spend less hours asleep and more awake, encompassed in this love. I can't stay, she whispered. She felt him tense. Nanny's home, she explained quickly, not wanting him to get the wrong idea. She'll need my help this morning with breakfast and bathing and things like that. She can do it for herself, but with the stroke and everything, I just need to make sure I'm there. He nodded. What? She can be here. You can be here. I can hire help, he whispered. Move in with me. Alani ran her fingers up the back of his neck, rubbing, massaging, still in his lap because he wouldn't let her go. I don't want to skip steps, Ethic. We miss so many things, she whispered. You want to slow down? Ethic asked, face reflecting displeasure. I want to, she paused and then shrugged. I don't know, date you, she said. I want to wait by the front door in a pretty dress and feel butterflies while I wait for you to show up. I want to fill in all those holes. I want easy memories with you, not just these grand moments of intensity. I want you to take me on a trip one day. I want to kiss you goodnight and then call you on the way home because I miss you as soon as you drive off. I want to hold your hand on Sundays in church. I want to rebuild our history, she fantasized. He knew she had thought of these things before because of the whimsical way in which she expressed them. Date you, huh? He said. He laid her on her back and kissed her lips, a quick peck, and then climbed out of bed. Is that okay? She asked. He ran his hand down his beard and then scratched the back of his head as his brows rose. Yeah, that's okay, he said. He wanted more. She knew it, but this process was important. Alani came up on her knees, beaming, as she hobbled to the edge of the mattress where he stood. She looked up at him. Thank you, she said. She climbed out of bed and headed to the shower. When she got to the doorway, she turned and saw him sitting on the side of his bed, head in his hands. Such an intense man. Yes, dating would lighten him some. It would be lighthearted. They would experience fun together. They needed that. She imagined he hadn't partaken in fun in a very long time. Shower sex is a part of dating, sir. He smirked as his gaze lifted. She curled her finger, beckoning him, before walking backwards into the bathroom, disappearing from his sight. She stepped into his shower and relished under the steam of hot water. It only took seconds for Ethic to join her. She felt the cool air infiltrate her space as he climbed in, then the hair on his strong thighs as he nestled against her behind. He hardened, and she moaned as he reached around her body, grabbing her breasts, tweaking her nipples with expertise. He sat on the built-in tile seat and pulled her down onto him. His lips kissed her back as she rolled him, his hand on her hips, guiding her rhythm, because he was so damn feeling that Alani had to go slow at first to get used to the magnificence of it all. She had never had a man make her want sex so much. She could count on one hand how many times she had opened her legs because she wanted to indulge in it with other men. With Ethic, every time she was game, every time she craved it, she never tired of it, never sickened of any of it. His touch, his stroke, the taste of him. He was so skilled at pleasing her, so unselfish. He wrapped one arm around her body and gripped her neck as he forced her back against his chest, arising to match her with deep strokes. Her mouth fell open as the shower rained over them, steam rising around them, thickening the air. His other hand found her clit and rolled it like he was shaping small beads of Play-Doh between two fingers. He bit her shoulder, and she never knew teeth could feel so erotic. It sent shockwaves to her clit, and he squeezed and rolled and kneaded it. She fell into spasms as she rained her love all over him. "Yes," she whispered. Her head fell back against his shoulder as she tried to catch her breath. His kisses against her neck and ear were so gentle, so appreciative, full of adoration. He was painting her with love and adding colors to her gray world. She felt it every time he touched her, even more when he brought her to orgasm. The energy, the love he left in her, on her. Like a stain to her soul, he was pouring something into her that she would never be able to get rid of. She lifted from his lap and dropped to her knees, taking him into her mouth because she wanted him to pour more. She wanted him to pour it all, to fill her with his essence because his DNA felt like nourishment. It kept her soul full. His toes curled and he fisted her hair as he watched and gritted his teeth. "Oh, shit," he groaned as he emptied himself. Alani decided then and there that there was no point in counting her orgasms with this man. Deciding to love him was like buying an unlimited wristband at the fair. She got unlimited rides. He gripped her shoulders, pulling her to her feet as he kissed her under the shower head. He washed himself and then her before climbing out of the shower. Wrapped in plush towels, they entered his bedroom. A knock at the door made Alani freeze. Her eyes widened in alarm. Busted. She felt like they had been caught red-handed with their hands inside the cookie jar. Ethic kissed her lips. "Relax," he said. "You belong here. Daddy, don't forget about my awards assembly at school. Easy's is today, too," Bella called through the door. "I got you, baby girl," he said. "Alani and I will be out in a bit." "Alani's here? Morning, Alani." Ethic heard the joy in his daughter's voice. He hadn't gotten a good morning. Bella had gotten straight down to business with him, but Alani... Bella beamed, for Monday morning blues had no wins against the presence of Alani in his home. He shook his head, smiling, because he understood it was the Fridayest Monday ever. Alani felt odd calling through the door. Her belly tightened, and apprehension filled it as she called out, "Good morning, B. I'll be down to cook breakfast. Give me 10 minutes. Lily's cooking lox and eggs." "I'll be down to cook you real breakfast," Alani called back. Thank God, Easy's voice was now behind the door. "Morning, Alani," Easy called too. Ethic turned to Alani with his arms held out. "What am I, the help? I can't get no love with you here, huh?" Her smile warmed him. He snatched her towel from her body and then pulled her near. She giggled, so lighthearted, so carefree, and it felt wonderful. She had lived 30 years of her life without feeling this type of joy. She had no idea how she had ever survived. She kissed him and then maneuvered out of his embrace because she was naked. He was wearing only a towel, and that was bound to lead to more sex. Neither of them had the time they would make to accommodate the pulse she could already feel reviving between her thighs. She began to dress. I completely forgot about the ceremony at B's school. I'm going to have to see if Mo can swing by the house to get her tuition payment. I was supposed to head to state to drop it off, but I can't do both, Ethic said. I can drop it off for you. I've got to meet the contractors today to do some work on the last few houses and stop by the college to check in on the progress of my publishing contract. But after that, I can link with Morgan, Alani offered. I wish I could come to the ceremony for the kids, but I've been trying to finish these houses for weeks. It's the first time I've been able to nail down a date with a contractor to meet to discuss the final details. I'll make them a special dinner tonight to make up for it. Damn, if this didn't feel good to him, her contributions, her partnership, her eagerness to help parent his children, to please him, to love them all. He looked at her in awe. What? She asked. That God thing that you're trying to get me to believe in. Yeah, she said, squinting. He had to make you. I believe that, Ethic said. She slipped into her jeans and walked over to him. Yeah, well, he made you too, Mr. Okafor. He's all up and through you. Alani opened the door, and just before she was out the room, Ethic said, I'm going to send you Messiah's address. You don't have to drive all the way to state. You can drop the check off to him later. He'll make the run for me. You just hurry home to me. Will do, she said with a smile. This felt routine. This felt normal. As Alani descended the stairs and heard the voices of laughter from two children she adored, she had to admit, it felt like home. And for the first time, she carried no guilt about being a part of it. And that's the end of that chapter. Childless. I'm sick of her. I don't give a fuck if the bitch got to stay woke 23 hours out of the 24 hours a day. Just stop acting a slap-ass fucking fool. Like, I'm so sick of her. This 5 minutes on, 30 minutes off bullshit is not. Look, she giving me gas and diarrhea and the bubble guts and constipating me all at the same damn time. Oh, my God. It's annoying, yo. It is annoying. All right, let me see what's going on here. Okay, hey, Kay. You catching up? You only 9 minutes behind now? Okay. Hey, happy all day with your happy all day ass. Listen, all of my Chicago peeps are in the building, you heard me? Okay, it's Chi-Town Day in the Speakeasy. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, big sis. I appreciate you. Sliding through to show some love. I'm out enjoying some of this weekend festivities. Oh, well, thank you. Oh, man. Have fun for me too, child. Listen, good oogly moogly. The Juneteenth of it all. You heard me? Yes, I am sick of her. But yes, she is finally seeming to get out of her own fucking way. Yes. Oh, it's annoying. It's annoying to have her just, oh, every time you turn around. Yes, south side in the building, son. Why is this pen not working? Hey, you got a lighter that I can hold to this pen because this is not working. You know how when you get a brand new pen and it doesn't, like you take the plastic part of it off, you know how these new ink pens come with that plastic cap over to keep the pen from leaking. I done took that part off and this helper still ain't in the right. Flick your big. And let's see if we heat it up a little bit, if that'll do it. Sometimes it takes a minute, this thing might pop. That's what he said. Yes, even on YouTube, I'm disgusted. This ain't working. Grab me another pen out the box. This pen is trash, garbage. I don't even understand this. All right, y'all. So we've been up here 2.5 hours. I told y'all.
I said, I'll be up here just a couple hours.
It's 7:19, child. I already missed 19 minutes of the darn show. This one is garbage too. Well, I don't like blue. What the fuck am I gonna do with a blue ass pen? That's disrespectful as fuck for you to have me a blue ass pen. All right, this will work. It's black. Black or red, that's it. Respect that. All right. Okay, so let's get this next one here. Here we go, y'all. This is going to be, I think this might be a good one. I'm sure Nordic know better, though, child. But we're going to see. Because, child, listen, that damn Alani is annoying. All right. Why is it doing this to me? All right, here we go. Chapter 6. Morgan sat on the couch. He took her in, breath catching in his chest because she was fucking exquisite. The heather gray sports bra and panties she wore rested against her light skin. The words Calvin Klein wrapped around the elastic band of her bra and the top of her panties. Even that name made him jealous. Another man's name on her body. Even if it was a label, his red and black checkered button-down shirt was like a robe over her shoulders, warming her slightly as it hung lazily on one side. It wasn't a damn thing little about little Morgan anymore. She was a bad bitch. And as he eyed the pizza box beside her, he wondered if she had answered the door like this. Messiah wanted to murder something. Morgan sat back, one leg propped up on the living room table, her back slouched against the red leather sofa. Rock stud heeled booties rested on her feet, and he knew she must have been breaking in a new pair because she walked around in heels all day like they were house shoes. To stretch them for when I dance, she would explain. Pause. I bet you the girl Wosey that came by was his sister, since we now know about the family. And maybe her child looks like him because the child looks like its grandfather. Maybe that's what it is. Like my son looks like a dark-skinned version of his grandpa on certain days. And then, it's hard to explain. So, you know, you never know how far back in the gene pool these kids will go. So, maybe she's his sister and that's his nephew. Might fuck around and even be his little brother, hell. Seemed like his daddy might have known, because his daddy been in jail for a long time. Shit, more than 18. And the daddy been dead for, her daddy been dead for a minute. So we're going to see. Speculation, but let's keep going. Her hair was middle parted and bone straight. A blunt was pinched between her fingers as she brought it to her red painted lips. She took a hit, something she rarely did, and she tilted her head back as she released the smoke slowly. That shit swayed out of her mouth like an exotic dancer seducing the air. His dick jumped. Sit down, Messiah, she said. His brows lifted. She was bothered. He knew her too well not to know that much, and her tone was lethal. What's wrong, shorty? Morgan hit the blunt again. He tried to scroll through his mental Rolodex to pinpoint the source of her disdain. Had she found something in his crib, a condom, that would certainly put her in a mood because they never used any. A random phone number? He had nothing to hide, but he wondered if something old had come back to disrupt the peace in his relationship. From the look on her face, something was awry. Messiah wouldn't even have entertained this conversation. This clear G-checking, a reprimand from anyone except her. He sat in the chair and leaned forward, elbows to knees, as he looked her in the eyes. I feel like some bullshit is about to come out of those pretty-ass lips, Messiah said, as he rubbed his hands together in anticipation. He was high, the lids of his eyes mere slits from the blunt he had smoked on the way home. Who the fuck is Wosey? She asked. Messiah's hand stopped moving, and he stood. Morgan reached for the pizza box, pulling out the handgun he had given her. She put it in her lap, finger on the trigger. I said, sit down, she said, but her voice skipped on the track like an old school CD. Her eyes missed it. Messiah lifted his hands. Mo. So, while you off doing who knows what, you got a visit, Messiah, she said. Mo, I can explain. You can explain a bitch showing up at your house carrying a baby on her hip? She asked. Morgan paused. The same house you told me you only bring people you trust to? People you love? Your words, not mine, Mo said as she brought the blunt to her lips and inhaled again. Fuck the baby in her stomach because she had already decided she wouldn't be baby mama number two. fuck I look like, she thought, growing angrier, her temper steeping like tea, marinating, growing stronger. She blew out the smoke as she pierced him with her eyes. You can explain a bitch telling me to tell you that you can't hide your family? Morgan asked. She wasn't yelling. He wished she was. She was detaching. This calm was scary. He zeroed in on the bags on the side of the couch. How hadn't he noticed them before? Messiah swiped both hands down his face. He was stuck. Stuck between what he should say and what he couldn't. Morgan sneered as she flicked the lit blunt at him, making him stand to brush the hot narcotic from his shirt. Yo, what the fuck? He shouted. He moved to come around the table, but Morgan lifted the gun. Ah, she said. Her composure was terrifying. Messiah stood frozen, like she had put up a stop sign. Red light, green light, nigga. Nobody had ever stopped him in his tracks before, but it was his queen, little Morgan, Mo Money, the pretty little deaf girl that he had given his heart to, commanding his every move. His palms were out at his side, at her mercy. All that loyalty shit you talk, she scoffed as she shook her head. She was so angry she couldn't cry, so angry that she was biting the flesh on the inside of her cheek. She tasted blood. Baby, she ain't shit. I swear to God I'm not cheating on you, Mo. I promise you. I promise, baby, Messiah said. It was all he could say. It wasn't an explanation, but what she assumed was better than the truth. It was less damaging than the secret he was hiding from her. Oh, no, you're not cheating on me. That bitch has a baby. You're cheating on her. You're just lying to me. You out here selling dreams, and I'm buying them bitches in bulk. You're fucking me daily, knowing. She paused because tears were coming, and she didn't want to cry. She pointed the gun at him. Red means dead. Safety off. Oh, the temperament of a young girl's heart. Messiah had fucked up. She was seconds off the trigger, and the aggression he had taught her had her contemplating pulling it. She shook her head. I'm off this. I'm done, Messiah. He felt his chest tighten when she bent to reach for her bags. It felt like his entire world was crashing. Mo, no, Shorty, no, baby, stop. Just give me a second. He couldn't believe it was his voice coming out of his mouth, begging anybody to stay in his life was a foreign concept. Messiah had turned into Keith Sweat. He was pleading so hard. All he needed was a smooth beat to lace his voice, and he would have a hit record. He couldn't let Morgan leave. The doorbell rang, and Morgan started for it. Messiah was right on top of her. Don't fucking touch me, she shouted as she snatched open the door. Aria and Issa stood on the other side. No, baby, listen, Messiah said. He was pleading as she pushed out of the house. You shouldn't have brought him, Aria, Morgan snapped. What's going on? Aria shrieked, caught off guard. You just said to come over. You didn't say come along. What the fuck is up? Aria shrieked as she eyed the gun in Morgan's hand. I just need a ride back to my place, Morgan said. She handed Aria a bag and then went back for the other one. Messiah trailed her like a dog. She don't need no fucking ride, Messiah barked as he snatched the bag from Morgan's hand. She's not going no fucking where, Messiah, Aria stated, looking back and forth between the couple. Nah, bro, get her the fuck out my crib, my G, before I lose my temper, Messiah said, pointing at Issa. Morgan aimed the gun point blank at Messiah's head. Lose your temper, nigga, she grit. Messiah had never seen this side to Morgan. This was all him. He had put all this gangster in her. She was him. And now she was leaving. He had given her all he had to give, his identity. If she left, who would he be? So I can lose mine. Please, Mo, hear me out, he said. His eyes were glossing over. Issa stepped up. Speak, Messiah. You not saying nothing. Who is Wozy? I don't hear nothing. Who the fuck is Wozy? Morgan jabbed his ass with every word. Then she pointed the gun to his chest. You broke my whole heart, Messiah. Riddle that shit without thinking twice. Issa hit Messiah with shocked eyes, and Messiah put both hands on his head as he turned his back to Morgan. Mo, sis, put the gun down, Issa said. Keep him away from me while I get the rest of my stuff before I shoot his cheating ass, she said, finally breaking lip, trembling as tears fell. Dirty dick-ass nigga, she mumbled while shaking her head in disappointment. She let the gun hang on her finger, letting go of the handle in surrender. Issa took it. Messiah sat where he stood, right there on the floor, elbows to knees, head hanging in despair as Morgan headed for the bedroom. Aria inched by him. I'm going to go try to calm her down, she said. Keep him in here, Issa nodded. Don't let her leave me, Messiah whispered. Aria heard so much hurt in his voice that her eyes missed it. She nodded and then rushed after Morgan. Issa rubbed his waves. Wolsey? I'm slapping fire from her stupid ass, Messiah said. Paint the picture for me, bro. So Mo knows? Issa asked. Messiah shook his head. Nah, she don't know that. Wolsey on some bullshit. Mo thinks she's a chick I'm busting down. She came over here with the baby on her hip talking some bullshit. Got it looking like I'm cheating. Ain't that better than the alternative? Issa countered. Let her breathe for a few days and get Wolsey in check. It's only so long you gonna be able to balance this shit, bro. We either gotta move on the shit or put the shit to bed. You lose her either way. You think I don't know that? Messiah asked. The question erupted out of him in frustration. He stood to his feet as Morgan and Aria came down the staircase. She was fully dressed and carried the rest of her belongings in his duffel bag. Her face was red, and it ate away at him because he knew she had gone upstairs to cry. If you leave me, I'm a dead man, Mo. This shit's gonna kill me, shorty, because I'm gonna go full force into this shit. Without you, I'm going to jail or I'm dying out here, Mo. Morgan stopped at the door. She closed her eyes as tears welled in them. The thought of either filled her with a hole so massive that she could fall inside it herself. Messiah stood and approached Morgan, wrapping a hand around her waist to pull her into him. He put his lips on the back of her neck and kissed there. I'm not cheating on you. Another bitch is the last thing on my mind. You have to trust that what you feel, how I make you feel, is real, he mumbled. Morgan closed her eyes. The sound of gravel crunching as a car pulled curbside popped them back open. Bro, Issa said. Messiah looked up and Morgan pulled away as the woman who had stirred up all the trouble emerged from the car. You almost had me, Morgan scoffed. She's pulling up to your house like it's her shit, like I'm sleeping in her bed. Clearly, I'm in the way. Let me remove myself. Morgan snatched out of his grasp and began crumbling as soon as she took the first step. Morgan's chin quivered as she tried to escape. The girl stood against her car, arms folded across her chest, face pulled tight and perturbed. Morgan wanted to hate her, but this was Messiah's doing. Mo, Messiah came after her, closing Aria's car door before she could climb inside. Who is she, Messiah? Messiah, cancel this shit and send the bitch on her way now. Wolsey piped up. Morgan's neck whipped in Wolsey's direction. She chuckled. Cancel me? I was trying to not be that chick that blamed the other woman for a nigga's lies, but don't try me. Messiah turned to Wolsey, pointing a stern finger. Yo, Wolsey, shut the fuck up. Get in the car and wait. He turned to Morgan, gripping her waist, holding her back. Mo, she couldn't believe she was standing here arguing with another woman over Messiah. Her Messiah. He was hers. How was he even allowing this to occur? Better get this bitch, Messiah, before I tell her some shit that'll hurt her little feelings, the girl said. Morgan's eyes widened, her stomach plummeted, and her heart sank. She pulled away from Messiah, pointing her stiletto-shaped fingernails in the shape of a gun in the direction of this girl. She felt a shift in the atmosphere, and she knew that today was the last day that she would be happy for a very long time. If she had known, she would have relished in it a little more. But life didn't work that way. Things were right until they were wrong. And by then, it was too late to appreciate the little things that had been insignificant before sadness became important. Like the forehead kisses he gave her. Something small felt huge now because she had a feeling she wouldn't be receiving any more from now on. I'll slap the shit out of you, ho. Who do you think you're talking to? Hurt my feelings. Morgan was so livid that she swung on Messiah. Stop touching me, nigga. You're protecting her? Who is this bitch? Whose feelings is she hurting? Morgan was like a Category 5 storm as she tried to get around Messiah. He put his hand to her chest. Mo, chill. Yeah, Morgan Atkins, sister of Raven Atkins, daughter of Benny Atkins, chill. Messiah had Morgan hemmed up as she dipped, twisted, and turned, trying her hardest to bulldoze through him. Hearing the names of her dead family members was like gasoline to fire. Who was this girl? She seemed to know everything about Morgan, yet Morgan knew nothing about her. Messiah was winded as he grappled with her, trying his best to keep her contained without harming her. He picked her up by the waist and then turned to the girl behind him with fire in his eyes. Shut the fuck up and get in the car. She better before she get done up out here, Aria threatened as she watched the scene unfold. Yo, baby girl, this ain't your beef, Issa said, putting a leash on Aria. Nigga, who are you? My daddy? I pop off when I want to pop off, and right now I'm feeling real froggy, Aria stated, challenging Wozie. We ain't even fucking yet. Boy, bye, Issa smirked, trapping her as he wedged her between the car and his body, looking down at her while licking his lips. Yeah, huh? Wozie held up her hands and shook her head in surrender. You niggas and these young-ass girls, handle that bitch, Messiah, and let's go, she snapped. Aria was like a dog out of race gate. She ran across the lawn, but Issa intercepted her, picking her up by the waist and pinning her against the car. Aria tied her long hair up as Issa held her firmly in place. That's okay, bitch. You can't hold me back forever, Aria said, nodding her head. She was already on go. Everyone was yelling. Aria, Morgan, Wozie waved them off unbothered. Handle me? Go? He ain't going nowhere with your dusty ass. This me. Every inch of this nigga is mine, you bum. She was so out of character, she didn't recognize herself. All she saw was red. All she heard was yelling. All she felt was anguish. Messiah couldn't stop her, so he picked her up and carried her over his shoulder into the house. Anger pulsed through her, and she attacked him instantly. Who is she, Messiah? He could practically see the steam coming from her ears. He grabbed her hands and pinned them above her head, trapping her body against the door with his. Guilt lived in his eyes. She didn't need his words. His body language spoke volumes. Sickness overcame Morgan. No, she cried as she hit the back of her head against the door again and again, trying to wake herself up because this had to be a bad dream. Her eyes pleaded with him as they watered. His heart cracked in his chest. He had known this day would come when the truth destroyed everything he had built with her. Sire, no, no, how could you do this to us? Morgan was melting, legs turning to goo beneath her as she slid down the door in despair. This is me. You said I was yours. Messiah kneeled with her, trying to scoop her into his arms, trying to build her back up, put her pieces back together, but she was destroyed. It was like seeing Wozie and Messiah in the same space made her inconsolable. One second, y'all. Okay, sorry, y'all. Mo, he whispered. Shorty. He had no explanations to give. He couldn't break her heart with a lie or break it with the truth. She sat with her elbows on her knees, head lifted to the sky, face drenched from her tears. Agony spread her lips wide as she tried her hardest to hold in these cries. Messiah moved the hair from her face, reminding her what his touch felt like, how gentle she made him. The thought of his hands touching the girl outside flashed through her mind in a split second, and she swatted his hands away. Her nostrils fled, and she buried her hands in her hair, pulling at the roots as if she was trying to snatch the image from her brain. She was on her feet next, running out the door before Messiah could hold her back. Mo! She heard him bark her name, but her feet were already flying across the pavement towards the black bins. She wondered if he had bought it for the girl, and that pissed her off more. Morgan's little nimble ass turned into a world-class boxer as the girl stepped off the car with her hands raised. The momentum from Morgan running full speed plus the punch she threw sent the girl over the side of the convertible. Morgan had zero fucks to give. She'd never let up. With a handful of hair balled in her fist, Morgan threw blow after blow. She had the girl stuffed in the bottom of the backseat head first, feet up, as she leaned over the car, relentless in her attack. Bitch! Morgan snapped as she tagged the girl. She was giving an old school ass whooping, commentating that shit like she was somebody's mama. I punch, told, punch, you, punch, not to play with me, slap, ho, mo, Messiah shouted as he grabbed her by the waist and bear hugged her, trapping her arms. Ha! Morgan shouted as she stuck out her entire tongue while trying to lunge over Messiah's shoulders. Bitch, who the fuck you think I am? Don't run up on me on some woman-to-woman shit over this nigga here. I'ma beat your ass every time I see you play with me. Wosie attacked, and with Messiah's attention on Morgan, he didn't realize he was putting her at a disadvantage until he felt the fist fly over his shoulder for Morgan. Aria slipped loose from Issa and broke across the lawn. Wop, wop, Wosie took two to the back of the head from the sneak from Aria before Issa could rein her in. We don't fight there, bitch. She swing. I'm swinging. Aria shouted over Issa's shoulder. Period, Morgan shouted. Wosie was still trying to get to Morgan, throwing all types of blows over Messiah as Messiah bear hugged Morgan, protecting her. As her little ass tried to shake him loose, it was chaos. Messiah turned, and the malice in his stare stopped Wosie mid-swing. This was bad. It was loud and out of hand. So much was at jeopardy. How would he let this catch up to him? Go to the fucking car, he barked. Yeah, bitch, skedaddle, Morgan goaded. Her mouth was reckless when provoked, but with Messiah as the muse shaping her attitude, her bite was vicious too. I was gonna give him back to you, bitch. Now I just might keep his dog ass, put him on a leash, and make him lick something for a treat, bitch. Yes, Morgan was talking real reckless, and if Messiah hadn't been so worried about losing her, he might have found the shit sexy. But he was desperate. He was terrified of what would happen next. One thing he knew for certain, Wosie stayed strapped. This could go left if he didn't get it under control. Well, she done already got her punk ass beat now, so what's up? Messiah heaved as he gripped the sides of Morgan's face. She pushed him. She hadn't forgotten that he was the cause of this. He was the reason she was coming out of character, tagging bitches in the middle of the street. The part that pissed her off most was that she had never seen the betrayal coming. He was so good at pretending. He put up such a good act of loyalty. She felt stupid. Her heart was broken. The anger hadn't erased the emptiness she felt. You said I was different, she sobbed. You promised to be different for me. He pressed his forehead to hers and closed his eyes at the feeling of her wet tears as he kissed her lips. You are, Mo. I just fucked up, shorty. I'm fucked up, he said, his voice cracking. I swear to God I love you. I love you, shorty. It's some shit I gotta clean up, but that's gonna always be a true story. She pulled her hands from his grasp and jabbed him and then slapped him. Messiah's type of crazy absorbed the blows. He liked the rage, the pain, but if he didn't stop her, she was going to do real damage. He hemmed her up, catching her wrist with one hand and pulling her into him with the other. Stop, shorty, stop, he whispered in her ear. He was pleading. Her breakdown was devastating to witness. She was touching him on the inside, her disappointment searing him. His insides had never felt this tender. Morgan? Morgan turned, stunned, to find Alani standing on the porch. Suddenly, all the ill feelings Morgan had toward her, all the jealousy and animosity, it all dissipated in that moment. Morgan needed her. She rushed to Alani, sobs spilling from her, devastation overflowing. Alani wrapped Morgan in her arms as she looked at Messiah in confusion. Her eyes darted around the scene as she tried to piece together the story without verbalizing questions. She knew whatever had occurred, it was devastating for Morgan. Mo, Alani looked up in stun at the vulnerability she heard in just the way Messiah said her name. Alani put the pieces of the puzzle together. Ethics soldier and his daughter, forbidden love. It always led to heartbreak. She shook her head as Morgan melted into her. Messiah, now might not be the best time, Alani whispered. She placed one hand around Morgan's shoulder and opened a palm under her chin. Shh, she consoled. Morgan was so incredibly hurt, it felt like someone was digging a hole through her. Uh-uh, Alani whispered. Hold your head up, baby girl. Don't let them see you like this. Messiah placed the palms of his hands on top of his head as he turned in frustration. It was so hard for him to see her this way. This was worse than the night at the hotel when she had been raped. How had he caused her the same dismay? He had raped her heart. He felt her energy leaving him. He felt himself losing her. It was like water slipping through his fingers. He couldn't hold on to it no matter how hard he tried. Oh, baby, he paused as he chose his words carefully. It's a lot I want to say to you, but I have somewhere I need to be. Morgan released Alani and wiped her tears, only for Moore to slide down her face. Figure that. Somewhere you need to be, she whispered. She scoffed in disbelief, as if you don't need to be here, like your obligation to me doesn't even matter. She thought of the baby growing in her stomach. She hadn't even told him yet. He was already leaving her, leaving them. They were already becoming those people she feared, the ones who loved the kid but hated each other. I need you, Messiah. Her hands said those words because she didn't want anyone else to know she was begging. If you leave here with her, I'll never forgive you. I'll get rid of everything you ever wanted with me. No love, no family. It'll be done. He rubbed his hands over his face. He felt cornered, and Messiah only reacted one way when he felt trapped. His entire past played in his mind. Things had been so clear until she had come into his world to blur his vision. Now he loved her. Now he was hurting her. His truth would shatter her. The truth. He was Maison's brother, and the girl outside wasn't some random girl he had been unfaithful with. She was Maison's sister. They had been grooming Ethic for years. For revenge. Ooh! Wee! Hold up. Pause. Pause. Motherfucker, pause. So this nigga was Maison's brother. And the girl outside wasn't some random girl. She was Maison's sister. And they had been grooming Ethic for years for revenge. She hadn't been a part of the plan. She had deterred him from the path. He couldn't speak that truth. That truth would annihilate her. Wow. Yo. So Ethic was mentoring Messiah. So wait, did they all have the different mothers and all had the same father? Like, how does that work? I said it. Yeah, I told you. You was trying to throw me off. That's it, Nordic. I'm mad. I'm not your friend. Never. Mm-mm. That's that girl's baby. Who give a damn who baby that is? I'm sure that's her baby. And if Maison and Messiah are her brothers, then yeah, I mean, you know, that. Listen, remember, he said Bookie, his daddy, was like him aged. So they all look alike. You know, they all favor each other. That's why the baby looked like him. So Maison's position will be exposed later. Okay. Child, listen. Oh, my God. So they never killed Maison, apparently. He must have got away then. He been laying low all this time? Child, listen. Okay, I ain't gonna guess. I said we gonna read all these books, and now I am tempted to fucking, it's 3 hours and 45 minutes left in this book. I know you lying. I done already missed one of my damn shows tonight. I got to get ready to get the fuck out of here. I gotta hurry to finish this chapter. Hold on. I can't miss the second damn show. All right. Shorty, are you leaving here with her, Messiah? Yes or no? Her voice trembled because she already knew the answer, and Messiah's hesitance only fueled the betrayal she felt. Morgan shook her head. Disappointment fell from her eyes, sliding down her face as the confidence he had filled her with the past few months left her. You just killed everything. I'm done with you, she said. Alani wrapped her arms around Mo, and Morgan rested her head on Alani's shoulder, bawling as she walked out. Messiah watched in dismay as his reason for breathing was put into the passenger seat of a little Prius and driven away. He saw red. Blind fury fueled him as he stormed out the door. Issa was smart to tuck Aria into her car and send her away because Messiah was on a warpath and headed straight for Wozie. Issa took quick strides to intercept, but Messiah got there first. What the fuck is wrong with you? Messiah asked as he wrapped his hands around his sister's neck and lifted her clean out of her shoes before slamming her hard against the hood of her car. She clawed at his hands and swung with all her might, but Messiah wouldn't let up. She had cost him everything. He could squeeze the life out of her. He could see the life leaving her as he choked her. damn near breaking her neck from the pressure of his hold. "Messiah, chill," Issa shouted. He pulled Messiah away. Wolsey scrambled, adjusting her clothes and pulling the bloodied lip Morgan had given her into her mouth. She pointed a stern finger in his face. "Don't blame this on me. Nobody told you to start fucking Morgan Atkins. You were here for one reason, to get X Connect and leave him slumped, the same way he left our brother slumped. That was it. Daddy laid out the plan clear as day and you fucking shit up. I can't get to the Connect. Ain't no Connect. Ethic ain't in the streets no more. I've been around a nigga for years. You know what he's schooling me on. Stocks, bonds, black history and shit. The nigga ain't even in the game. He practically raised me. He came around the block buying a nigga new shoes because he heard the other kids teasing me about the ones I dug out the lost and found at school. He bought me new backpacks for school. He taught me how to throw a football, gave me my first rubber. I knew him before Mizon ever had a problem with him, and y'all just want me to put a bullet in his back? He was a good nigga then, and he a good nigga now, and I'm underneath him, watching him, lurking like a fucking snake waiting to bite. He got three fucking kids who need him. I've been to birthday parties and recitals and shit. Fuck him. Fuck them. Mizon raised you," Wolsey defended with tears in her eyes. "Nah, he raised you. He was different with me. It's more to family than blood." Messiah was so livid he spit when he spoke and jabbed a finger into her forehead. "That nigga," grief choked him as his words caught in his throat. He was about to reveal too much, about to share secrets that he had promised to take to his grave, secrets that had turned him into an aggressive little boy, an even more aggressive grown man. A man. Those secrets had made him a man because he had vowed to be so tough that nobody would ever be able to make him feel like he wasn't a man ever again. "That nigga what? Mizon came around and made sure you had food in your stomach after daddy went to prison. He ain't have the same mama. He didn't have to do that. He never treated us like half anything. He loved us with his whole heart. Mizon was all we had and Ethic murdered him. That spoiled bitch you knocking down. Her father set daddy up to go to prison. Why do you think Mizon set Benny Atkins up to be arrested instead of killing him? It was payback. Why do you think he got with Raven Atkins in the first place? Payback. You were the only one going against the family. Finish your plate. Daddy taught you better. You don't leave nothing on your plate. You either knock off Ethic or I'm knocking off the bitch that got you so distracted. Your choice," Wolsey said. Messiah backed her up against the car and grit his teeth so hard his jaw hurt. He was seething, nostrils flaring as he pointed a finger in her face. "Hit me clear, Wolsey. You touch her and I'm going to murk you." "You going to kill me, Messiah? I'm your sister, your flesh and blood. I'm all the family you got. You ain't gonna do shit," Wolsey said, pushing him away from her hard. Two siblings, underloved, with so much aggression. They had a lot to be angry about, and what once had been a team was now two different people with dissenting agendas. She had no idea the things Messiah had done and would do on Morgan's behalf. Wolsey was wading in dangerous waters. She didn't want to put Messiah in a position to choose because she wouldn't win. "Cut her off and get your head back in the game. Ethic or Morgan Atkins?" She set out the ultimatum as if it were a simple choice. She was on the outside. She wasn't up close to the dirt, so she could never understand how hard it would be for him to choose between them. Wolsey snatched her door open and got in the car, peeling off into the night. And that's the end of that chapter. I'm so goddamn nosy. This is insane in the membrane. How many chapters in this fucking book? 22. Bitch, I know you lying. Okay, I'm out, y'all. This is crazy. All right, y'all. Y'all got 6 chapters out of me when I originally came up here just to give y'all 2. Okay? So y'all done finessed my ass. And got a whole conversation about good dick versus bad dick. And a high body count. Y'all ain't shit. Y'all just use and abuse me. Lord have mercy. All right. It's all good, though. All right. Y'all listen. I am just like, this is crazy. Yeah, Messiah is what you call, yes, it is addictive. Messiah don't even know. Oh, Messiah don't know Mizon is dead? Okay, well, he just found out, I guess. Yeah, this is crazy. This is, Yeah, he a real G because he raised the boy and did whatever. Yeah, Messiah Corn, I mean, Maison Cornbread definitely was not done, child. Wow. Ethic a good dude. He just be helping out the children's and shit. Make you want to give him some pity coochie, don't it? But he don't need it because he getting it from Alani, love weird ass. And here comes Alani to the rescue. She showed up right on time, child. Just like a mother does. Well, when you have a good mother, child. My mother never showed up on time for shit except for the kickoff in my ass. It beat the shit out of me because I had an old smart ass mouth. Ooh, y'all, my mouth was so fucking smart when I was a kid, you heard me? But no getting around that shit. I mean, it ain't like it ain't smart now. Y'all go forth and be great. This was fun. Okay, you said that was Maison's people. I don't know. Did you, girl? Child, listen. Look at Love Jones with the Buckeye emoji. Like, oh my God, what is happening right now? Oh, Lord have mercy, child. Listen. I am tripping. This is crazy. I mean, it's so good, though. What the hell, y'all? What the hell? Oh, man. Yeah, I had peaked it because I was just like, what the fuck? This is insane. I mean, like, the way that he did it, though, just, I don't know, like, and for his daddy and all them to be, you know. Not you need to know what's about to happen, girl. Bye. Girl. I know, right? Exactly like I would. Always with a twist or a turn and some sneaky shit. But my sex scenes would be a hell of a lot more freaky dicky, child. Need some handcuffs and riding crops and cat of nine tails and fire cupping and spanking benches and fucking sensory deprivation and all types of freaky dicky shit going on if I was right in the book. I know, right? I want to know what happened, child. Listen. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you did say that. You sure did about the phone conversation. You sure did. You right, Kay. You did. Yes, some pity coochie, child. Oh, he know my side. He know Messiah knows my Zahn is dead. He don't know the position that he played in his life. He don't know the position that who played in whose life. Wait, I'm confused by what you said. Wait, was Maison molesting Messiah? Because he was saying some shit like, he was like, that nigga, and then he said something about, so Maison don't know, wait, let me keep reading the comments because I'm reading on two different devices. And when it pops up on StreamYard, I done already seen it on the other thing. Okay. So wait. Okay. I need to know what's about to happen, girl. No, God. That's your little sneak way of begging. Little sis. No, ma'am. I love you, boo. To the moon and back, around the sun like Icarus, and all the way back to the earth. I love you that much. I will fly around the universe for you, ma'am. And that's a big-ass motherfucking long-ass motherfucking flight. But no God. Okay. And so, I am. Aw. So you can read and get another way. So he don't know Maison like he think he know him. Okay. But I think something happened between Maison and Messiah. The reason why, because he said something. Remember, Messiah said the nigga did something. And then he said something about whatever happened between him and Maison made him a man so that nobody would ever think that he wasn't a man. So I'm wondering what that is. Okay, that's what I said. So Maison was a motherfucking creep stain. So he molested Messiah. Motherfucker. Damn. That's fucked up. Well, fucking Messiah should just pop his sister. Fuck her. That bitch weird anyway. And your daddy went to jail because his bitch ass needed to go to jail. Kill that bitch. And fuck it. I'm so fucking ignorant. I'm talking about kill that bitch. Listen, I'm from Chicago. It's only certain niggas you let breathe, okay? Niggas and bitches can catch it, right? Fuck that. So wait, so she said, keep reading. It gets wild. I mean, not today, but yes, the next time you go like, oh yeah, I'm definitely going to keep reading. Yes, he molested him. Yes, that was a spoiler. The situation with Maison goes deep. Really? Child, listen. This is insane. What you eating? I want some. What's that? I don't want that. Listen, I'm like a little kid. I want some. Don't even know what the fuck he got in his mouth. I want some. Oh, God. Listen. It's a child. This is crazy. This is crazy, y'all. Damn. It's 8:01 now. Okay, y'all. If I don't stop now, I'm gonna be up here all motherfucking night. I know you lying. Nah, this taking me back to the times that I was so fucking nosy with them Carl Weber books that I was like, fuck that, we finishing this shit, and knew I had other shit to do, and we would just finish it. Oh, have mercy. Yes, great writing. Ashley is good. She's good. Man. And I want to read that book, I want to read the cartel series that she and her husband wrote together. Child, listen. Cause I'm like, what the hell? I am, because shit, I done already missed my damn show now. Shit, it's 8:01. But anyway, I'm gonna go and chill, child. Cool out. It's Saturday, and it seemed like the Clear folks have ended the pool party, so maybe it can be a little quiet now. Right. Now, that's true. Yeah, and that happens a lot. Now, wait, I got questions, and only the book can answer them. But, Yeah, I know, right? Because I do. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. There's so much shit going. I do. I want to stay. You know how little kids be like, I want to go home. I want to Oh, my God. I forgot where I left off. Where I left off. I got to finish up this Dirty D shit your ass got me hooked on. Kim, motherfucking Cash. Careful. Got me hooked on that shit. Lord have mercy. Oh my God. I am halfway through episode 3. Child, listen. Ooh, that girl's sister is a trip, child. Oh, I want to punch that bitch in her face. And she remind me of them heifers from Detroit, child. Some of them, you know what I told the ladies? I said, yeah. She, that's the real reason why I don't like Kenya Moore. She remind me of them grimy ass, Gargamel ass hoes from the D. That's who she remind me of. And that's where she from. They some grimy ass motherfuckers, man. They some Gargamel ass bitches. Like, I mean, you know, I'm from Chicago. We could be a motherfucking handful, a fucking tsunami if you fuck up. But be a fucking category 6 storm for the right scenario. However, them motherfuckers from the D, shh, I done seen them motherfuckers lay their own mamas down. I mean, not that that's a bad thing if she need it, but I'm just saying, they do that shit like, it's 2 o'clock on Thursday. I ain't got shit else to do. Let me go on over here and snuff mama's lights out right there. I was like, ow. I just don't like them. Yeah. Now, I thought chicks from Chicago was bad. No God. Hey, Kay, you all caught up now? We over here wide-eyed and bushy-tailed. Oh, my God. Y'all a mess, child. Listen. I know, but see, I don't want to listen. What I don't want to do is ask a question that is, I know is going to be answered in the book, but it's going to, I ain't going to ask. I'm just going to wait. Okay, all fucking day. Yes, indeed. Yes, they scandalous as fuck, okay? Oh, my God. Oh. Man, this is crazy. They the type of bitches that invite you to their house and they know they got the chicken pox. And then when you get the shit, they be like, you shouldn't have came over here. Bitch, you could have told me. Like, what the fuck? Oh, my God. You know, I'm like, what the hell? I mean, it's bad. It's just, they just some bad people. I don't know. I don't even know. Yes, keep quiet. Don't say nothing, Nordic. I'm going to just keep reading. All right, so listen, y'all. I'm going to get the fuck out of here because I got to handle up on some shit right quick, and I got to finish this damn show because I'm going to tell y'all right now, I stayed up till like 2-something this morning. No. Okay, so I fell asleep on my system. On the phone. But that ain't nothing, dude. And then after I got off of her, I waked up. I was like, okay, I'm awake now. Oh, yeah, that's just a fool in a dirty D. That bitch need her ass beat, like, for real. I don't like that hoe. But then, you know, I had stayed up. I swear I was only sleep on my sister for like maybe 30 minutes. She didn't even say shit. She just let me sleep. Bless her heart. Her loved me, so her let me sleep. And then I woke up like had shit happen, like I always do. Y'all, I be gone. And I woke up. And then I was like, okay. And then I might have caught another. No, I didn't. Yeah, I was up. I've been up, y'all. All these days crossing up, but no, I didn't. I didn't go back to sleep. That was it. And so I was trying to catch the rest of these episodes. And then I started, I was trying to catch up on all of the people on YouTube that I watch. And then, of course, you know, you got to get your meditation and your prayer in. And then after that, shit, it was like daytime outside. I was going to try to lay down, but the neighbors started doing yard work early, cutting grass, weed whacking and leaf blowing and all that bullshit. So I was like, fuck it, I'm up. Just get it together. And then after that, yeah, because they start cutting grass at like 6-something. Yeah, because the sun be bright and it be hot and they be trying to get it over with. So, yeah, that's when you jump in the shower, brush your teeth, wash your face, get your day started. So, yeah. But I got stuff I need to finish up. And so, yeah. Well, I'm sorry, y'all. And I still got other stuff got to finish watching on YouTube because, child, apparently, listen, pause for a fucking second. Kim Cash gonna say, damn, that plan didn't work. We're trying to keep you. I know what y'all be doing. So you'll be like, fuck it, I'll keep reading. No, ma'am. Nope, I already know. Listen, game recognize game. Game just don't be saying nothing. So Apparently, y'all, it's a whole lot of shit going on the YouTube streets. Jag is back jagging, and oh, I was like, what the hell is happening? Like, shit is falling apart. These videos are coming back to back to back. I'm like, what is wrong with her? Like, child, I don't know. Everybody and their grandma doing a video about the woman. And, you know, like I said, you know, I've missed out on so much. So I have lots of those videos that I need to watch. And, yeah, I got a whole lot of it. Because, like, I'm out of the loop on everything that's happening. You know, the who shot John of it all. And something about people taking their name off of shit. And she out and done left the place where she was supposed to be living. And somebody says she done kidnapped somebody. I'm like, how you kidnap a person? Like, you don't kidnap somebody when you ain't got no fucking where to stay your goddamn self. So somebody might have left willingly, but I don't think an addressless person really kidnap you? Because where they gonna keep you at? Like, I don't like, don't they have some place to take you to? I mean, like, I'm just like, oh my God. Like, how does that work? Oh, it's just, yes, too much. And like, some of the people I don't even watch. So I'm going to have to find the people who do the recap of all the shit. I'm going to have to find those people because some people I don't fuck with. So I don't watch their videos to, you know, to see what's popping with like the whole you dig. But I heard that Jag and the lady got up on somebody's channel, child, and it was a whole bunch of blobbity blob. Y'all, this is like real life for somebody. Yeah. Yes, she does. A whole lot. And that's why I just want her to just address that, ma'am. Let's just please get that under control and then get back to making magical music. Because, girl, you were blessed by the universe with a set of pipes that just, oh, that woman sing and make the hair stand up on the back of my neck. Like, I cannot even, oh. And I really don't get it. I don't understand why she won't just deal with that. You know, because, you know, I'm sure I know why. Because her medicated self doesn't feel like her unmedicated self. And that's the part that people have trouble reconciling. And yes, she can, baby. Yes, she can. And it's really... is really sad. Because in a world right now that could use her type of music, with all the trash that's out there by all these people that, like I said, I don't even know who these people are, child. I'm just like, who the fuck wrote that song? Like, you hear it in a movie or whatever. And I'm like, I ain't never even heard of this person, but I don't know. There's an absence of just good music, like just good fucking music. It's good old-fashioned music. It's just not there anymore. So I just wish that she could get all that shit in check, and she's still young enough to still have a wonderful fucking career. She could sing all the way to the day she died. And she could just make a whole lot of money and bring a whole lot of joy to people. I mean, she is talented beyond measure. And I'm just like, oh my God. And it really, I hate this. I hate this shit. This 5 minutes of fame shit that YouTube is, the 5 minute notoriety. Listen, it ain't even like a quickie. It's like coitus interruptus. It's like you get it real quick and then it's gone. Like, why would anybody want that? I don't get it. Like, I just... Like, man, you could be doing so much. Just go do what you were born to do, which is sing. Oh, my God. And I don't know. It's just tragic. And, child, I get teased all the time.
Oh, Saki, you and Jaguar, all right. Every time I turn around. You feel so much sympathy for Jaguar. I feel sympathy for Black women, period. So, like, what am I supposed to do? I can, you know, I mean, I can shut it off for certain people, you know, bitches I don't fuck with. Listen, that sounded real harsh, didn't it? Bitches I don't fuck with. Right. But, you know, for people that, like, I see, like, Jag is a genuine soul. She just got lost, y'all. She just got lost. In her own mind, she got lost. But that does not in any way negate her talent. That woman is fucking talented. I don't give a fuck. You could call her crazy, insane in the membrane, deranged, a liar, or whatever you want to call her. The bitch can sing, and you'll never be able to take that away from her unless you snatch her vocal cords out of her body. You can't take away her talent. You can call her whatever you want to, but you can't call her a non-singing bitch, because Jag done smoked a lot of motherfucking Newports, and that bitch still sound good when she put them motherfucking vocal cords to work. Fuck what you heard. Argue with your weird-ass neighbors. You know, the ones behind you. The fuck? So I really just wish that she could find the peace necessary to create some beautiful music like she used to, because, I just really, really, she could really, really get it. Yeah. I don't know. For YouTube fame, fuck that shit. Goodbye. You could be fucking soothing the savage beast and a whole lot of people with your vocal cords, and you out here acting a whole donkey on YouTube. Get your shit straight, ma'am. If you ever hear this, please get yourself together and do the shit that brings you joy, motherfucker. And that's singing. Because I know that shit brings you joy. I done seen it in your face, bitch. When you hit them motherfucking notes, I said, oh, that one right there? Yeah, that came from behind her motherfucking navel. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. When them arms fly out and their head go to the side, bitch, please, get back to that. Because that's where your fucking joy is. All this other bullshit, all this knick-knack, patty-whack-ass bullshit, man, get that shit a rest. You too, first of all, you too fucking seasoned for that shit. That's first. And second of all, bro, bye. You missing out on some real motherfucking joy. And some money. Fucking around on YouTube. And if YouTube has got to be the platform that you choose to burst back on the scene with, then fucking get your channel together. Because you got the people over there, and they'll come and fucking watch. They already watching. I just don't get it. The mental illness is real, y'all. But you gotta find a reason, honey. And until you find your reason, nothing I say, nothing anybody says is ever going to penetrate. Because you can't hear it right now. That's the sad part. That's the sad part. Anyway, y'all, now I'm sad. Not really sad, just like, you know, you get melancholy when you think about, you know, wasted talent. It's like when you see somebody that's really talented at something, but then they get hooked on drugs or become an alcoholic or, you know, be out here just all fucked up in the game and don't use their fucking, yes, just, it's effortless, Marva, effortless, just like inhaling and exhaling. Man, I don't even get it. But you hate to see somebody, you know, just caught up in whatever and missing out on life. Because this bullshit, this back and forth and all this fucked up shit you going through right now, this ain't living, boo. I don't even think you existing right now. You here, but you ain't here. Mm-mm. Not in the way you want to be.
not in the way you need to be. Damn. That's enough to make you feel some type of way. So listen, I'm going to get the fuck out of here. Because, So thank y'all for listening to me read out loud. I'm going to come back tomorrow after all of the people get through making noise, child. For whatever reason, these queer folks like to be outside in all this fucking heat in Texas, child. It'd be hotter than a fucking well digger's asshole while wearing leather. You heard me? It'd be hot outside. Insanely hot and humid for no fucking reason at all. It's just like a whole nother, it's like a gorilla on your back, just like blowing on your neck like that. And you turn around like, bruh, back up. And nobody's there. That's the humidity. Yeah, that's the humidity, bro. It just be, that should be resting on you. You like, damn, it's hot. You look out the window. Or maybe that's just my ignorant ass. I be looking out the window like, it look hot out. It look hot, not just hot. It look hot, right? Well, you gotta open your whole mouth. It look hot, like H-A-A-A-A-A-T, hot. There's no O in that, child. It's just A, like it's hot outside. Oh my God, that's the way it be down here. For no fucking reason at all, other than Texas is the asshole of America. Think about your butt. It's hot. Right. All right. So, yeah, I'm going to come to y'all tomorrow at some point. Listen, Nordic, my cornbread is not done, child. I don't know what the fuck might come out of my mouth over here. That's why I ain't done my kick in the Willy Bobo yet, because when I tell y'all what I'm going to talk about, it's going to be really, I'm not gonna have anything nice to say. Yes, and listen, I don't talk about all the shit when everybody else talks about it. I talk about it when the fuck I feel like it. So some of this shit is going to be old, but I'm still going to tell you what the fuck I think about it, and it's not going to be nice because I don't feel nice about pretty much nothing on this list. Well, maybe a couple of things I feel good about, but you know, most of it is just shit that pissed me off. So yeah, you know, I'm gonna talk about it. And yeah, so you know, most people would be like, why the fuck she just now talking about that, bitch? Cause I can. And what? That part. So yeah, but it's not gonna be nice though, cause I don't have anything nice to say about any. I don't, cause it's all bad. Yeah, you know, a couple things on the list, like I said, I have good thoughts about, but the rest of it, fuck out of here. Because a lot of this fucking pusillanimous sycophancy needs to stop with these niggas. And they running around here just, I don't know, this is just, y'all know my cornbread is not done. All right, so listen, y'all go forth and have a great, great Saturday night. I'm getting ready to fix my motherfucking plate so I can eat and try to finish up this dumbass fucking bullshit that Kim Cash and got me hooked on. Sitting over here watching light skin, strong fat. And the nigga name, he got the nerve to have a name like Malik. Nigga, you know your name should be something stupid like Derek. You know, because like he a fat, light-skinned dude with a pregnancy in front of him. I don't know. Your name should be something like Walter. He look like an old fat nigga named Walter. Looking like a fucking bully with a t-shirt on. Like your name should be Sam. Just, ugh. Anyway, asshole. So, yeah. All right, y'all. This was fun. Thank y'all for listening to me read out loud. I truly appreciate you. I know y'all about to travel the highways and byways. I might catch y'all out there somewhere. If certain people go live, I'll be in their chats, y'all. If you know where to find me, then you know. But for the most part, it's some shit I don't watch on YouTube. But anyway, I might see y'all in the streets, child. Yeah, he do look like a fat ass Walter. He look like a black SpongeBob SquarePants. That fucking eraser top on top of his head, and his face looks square like a sponge. I don't like his ass. I don't like him at all. He might be a nice guy in real life, but he sucks because the character he plays is old shiesty fat motherfucker, and I don't like him. All right, that part. So anyway, listen. Oh, thank you, darling. Love you back, and you enjoy your Saturday as well, darling. So listen, y'all look both ways before y'all cross the streets of the YouTubeverse, all right? Thank you, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire. Thank you for being such a wonderful moderator. I truly appreciate you. And listen, y'all, make sure y'all like the video on your way out the door. And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all.